Good morning, everyone. Thank you for showing up. It's so nice. I've been working on this event since about March, so it's nice of everyone to show up. On behalf of University of Detroit Mercy School of Law and the Law Review, I want to welcome everyone to the Great Lakes Symposium. We're a tad behind schedule, but that's okay. So I'm going to be really quick here. I just wanted to personally thank all the presenters and the moderators for showing up today and taking time out of your busy schedule to show up. So if we could give them a round of applause, please. Thank you. And at this time, I want to introduce the Provost and Vice President of Academic Affairs at the University of Detroit Mercy, Pamela Zarkowski.
Thank you, Justin. Well, good morning. I am so thrilled to be here on behalf of the university administration. And so this is a very exciting event for the School of Law. I'm grateful to Jackie Hand and to Dean Crocker and Megan Jennings for inviting me. That's always nice when they think about administrators because we're on another campus. And I'm especially glad to be here, lost Justin, because I too was on Law Review in the last century and was the articles and book review editor, not for this particular law school, but for Wayne State University. And so I really know how hard all the Law Review staff and editors work, not only for a symposium such as this, but also as a part of what their work is during their academic years here, balancing their academic program as well as their writing and editing obligations. Thank you to all the guests who agreed to come here. If you've not been to the University of Detroit Mercy School of Law, we're very proud of this particular institution. This building itself has a lot of history as the university and the high school, the University of Detroit Jesuit High School, started here in downtown Detroit two centuries ago, as it were. And so you feel a lot of the history and the greatness that came out of this particular institution. I also want to say, and not all of you know this, and I'm going to pull up my name tag, but we have the School of Law, of course, has its mission statement, and the University of Detroit Mercy is in parallel with that. And we say that our education intends to integrate the intellectual, spiritual, ethical, and social development of students. And looking at the topic today, I really feel like it is touching on at least three of those aspects of what we feel is the mission of the University of Detroit Mercy. So truly, looking at the Great Lakes, thinking about the social implications of that, the ethical obligations of us as citizens and as attorneys and as individuals who have voices in various places, just really speaks to the mission and who we are. Now, just as a quick aside before I introduce Dean Crocker, I started my career as a dental hygienist. And so I have to tell you, when I'm reading about toothpaste beads in the water, it gives me a little bit of pause about what the toothpaste industry is doing to our wonderful Great Lakes. But fascinating connection. And so I will remind you to brush and floss, but I will tell you not to use that toothpaste that has those beads in them, because I have a feeling there's some implications based on some of the literature that we've been reading most recently. So it's now my very distinct pleasure to introduce one of my favorite deans, Dean Crocker, to give you greetings as well. Have a great day. Thank you.
Thank you for being here. I am the dean. It's a privilege to be the dean of this great law school in this great city. And one of the things I love about this building is that you can see the city right out the window. So you can look out there in one of our tall buildings there. When you, at breaks, if you go down the hall and look out the windows of some of the classrooms down at the end, you can see Canada, really, right across the room. So. Take advantage of that. I'm so glad that you all are here today to have this important conversation about public trust and our Great Lakes. I know we will learn a lot and have wonderful conversations with each other. Thank you to the Law Review, Justin, for organizing this, but to all of you, I know you have worked on it. So would all the Law Review members stand so we can thank you. Wonderful to have all of you here, too. I would also like like to thank our faculty advisor for this symposium, Professor Hand, and our faculty advisor for the Law Review, Professor Belling, and Megan Jennings, our assistant dean for student affairs. Enjoy the day. Thank you all for being here.
I'm going to make these introductory remarks very brief because we have wonderful speakers to share their expertise with us throughout the day. We're absolutely delighted to have you all here joining us to discuss this really important topic. The Great Lakes Basin is the largest body of freshwater in the world. It's roughly 20% of the world's entire freshwater supply. It serves as drinking water for over 30 million people. It provides a background ecosystem for important plants and animals, and it is really beautiful, which is equally important. This resource is, however, under quite a lot of pressure from a variety of sources, ranging from invasive species like the lamprey and the Asian carp to microscopic beads that we're going to hear about, plastic beads that we're going to hear about today. We'll be exploring the principle of the public trust doctrine, which is a very ancient one, to serve as a source of protection for this really important resource. And I want to share with you, when in my second year of law school, I was introduced to the public trust doctrine, it was so exciting, having spent a year of doing torts and contracts about individual rights, to all of a sudden find that there was a long-standing doctrine that protected the public good, that all of us are beneficiaries of a trustee. This was just at the very beginning of the environmental movement, and I didn't know there was anything else like that out there, and it made being in law school a whole lot nicer than just worrying about financial sorts of issues. The only other point I want to make before we move into the regular program is we had hoped to, but were not able to bring in a representative of the tribes or First Nations today. The folks who we hope could come are actually at PrepCons for the climate change conference coming up in Paris. And I think it's important to recognize the mindset that these folks bring. The Great Lakes are core to the culture of the Anishinaabe people on both sides of the border. They have been active in protecting the lakes from time immemorial down to very recent lawsuits to try to protect various aspects of quantity and quality of the lake. And I want to share with you an activity by a group called the Water Walkers, which is a collection of clan mothers that over the last 10 years have, about one a year, walked the entire circumference of each lake carrying a bucket of water to symbolize how absolutely core water is to our life, both spiritual and physical. And I just wanted to share with you their statement that most of us, as far as I know, do not have tribal heritage, but their culture is also part of our heritage as Americans. And I think this sort of puts what we're doing today in context. Our ancestors have inherited the Great Lakes since time immemorial, long before current political boundaries were drawn. Our spiritual and cultural connections to our Mother Earth are manifest by our willingness to embrace the responsibility of protecting and preserving the land and water. Let's keep that mindset in our heads as we listen to all of the specifics of trying to apply this doctrine and protecting our lakes. Thank you. Introduce our first panel. And you have biographies in your program, so I'll not put a lot of detail, but our first speaker is Noah Hall from Wayne State, who has been very active both in scholarship around the Great Lakes and in various important pieces of litigation. I'm going to go ahead and just give all the names for the first. Our second is James Huffman, a longstanding, well-respected law professor, recently retired from Lewis and Clark Law School, who's also written extensively on the Great Lakes. And our final speaker for this panel is Alexis Andaman, who is with the Conservation Law Center and is beginning what I hope will be a long career of working particularly to protect our important resource. Noah, pass to you.
Good morning. Thanks to everyone for coming out on a Friday. Fridays in law schools are a little bit of a tough sell, but this is a really important topic and a wonderful place to celebrate it. And in addition to thanking Professor Hand, Justin Miller from the Law Review, I really want to thank all of you for coming out. We have a really fantastic panel of speakers today. I'm honored to know most of them personally. I know all of their work very well. These are some of the most thoughtful, dedicated environmental thinkers we have in our community. And I'm excited to hear what they have to say about the public trust doctrine, far more than what I have to say about it. I'm going to give you, since I'm batting lead off, I do have some ideas and maybe a few unique things to offer. But before I get into that, I think I should probably get everybody on the same page about the public trust doctrine and provide a little bit of background. So that way, we could all just be a little bit more informed as we hear the different presentations and ideas thrown around today. The public trust doctrine is really the foundation of the law of water, not just in the United States, but in most English common law, law and governance systems. Academics love to write about the public trust doctrine, just hundreds and hundreds of journal articles. Environmentalists love to promote it, in large part because the public trust doctrine is seen as almost the antidote to market failures, private property, and failure of government to adequately protect the resources that they should be stewarding. Courts maybe don't love the public trust doctrine quite as much as academics and environmentalists, but the courts have given us some very clearly defined doctrinal rules about what the public trust doctrine is and what it's not. And I think as you'll see from both my remarks and the presentations today, when the public trust doctrine involves core when litigation involving the public trust doctrine involves the core concepts that courts have delineated, courts are actually very protective and enthusiastic about applying the public trust doctrine. And it's when it attempted to be expanded into other areas that you see more mixed results. So the public trust doctrine, I think the best way to understand it, especially for folks who don't have a background in this area, is to think of the public trust doctrine in two ways. First of all, the public trust doctrine provides both a conceptual and a physical limit on private property. The public trust doctrine shows us where private property ends and the commons begins. This is often played out in a physical sense. For example, on Great Lakes shorelines, which several of our speakers are going to be discussing, exactly where on a Great Lakes beach the end of public rights end and the commons end and private property begins, and often it's overlapping. But also conceptually, where your rights as a private property owner or an individual might give way to the rights, the needs, the responsibilities of the public at large, the sovereign entrusted to protect public rights, and future generations. And as you might imagine, as with all legal issues, the core, the basic aspects of the public trust doctrine are very well settled. There's little dispute and a lot of consensus about what the public trust doctrine is and is not in those settings. But it's on the margins where the public trust doctrine is interfacing with those private rights, both physically and conceptually that you see both disagreement and room for legal reform. The second area, or the second way the public trust doctrine operates to define the law of water, is the public trust doctrine shapes, just as riparian law, which introduced this concept briefly, just as riparian law shapes your private rights to water. Riparian law is the law dominant in the eastern United States. In a nutshell, it provides that landowners adjacent to water bodies have specific rights to that water body, correlative to their neighbors. It's a usufructory right, meaning it's a right of use, not a right of possession. And it's based on reasonableness, much like you might have learned in property under nuisance law. And just like riparian law defines your private rights to water, the public trust doctrine defines not just the public rights to water, but the nature of the state's title to water resources. And this is a rather tricky concept that's important to understand as we get into the presentations the rest of the day. In the United States, based on the equal footing doctrine, states have title to navigable waters and the lands below them. But that title is not like the title that you have to your home or to a piece of real property. And just like this, the state's title is really one more as a steward or a trustee. And the public trust doctrine provides the specifics of how the state must steward its public trust duties and administer its title. Public trust doctrine in this way limits, not empowers, states. And so one of the hardest things I think for folks to get their head around with the public trust doctrine is that while it both limits private rights, it also limits the sovereign exercise of power by the state, which often leaves us wondering, well then who's in charge? And the answer is the doctrine itself, as enforced by courts. There is room in our world for something to be neither up to government nor up to private property owners. There are natural resources, and I don't mean that term in the economic sense, but in the more true natural sense, that belong to all of us. They don't belong to government and they don't belong to private individuals. And the public trust doctrine shows us how we must steward those resources and the parameters for using those resources. The basics of the public trust doctrine, what it provides, I think what we will all be able to agree on. The public trust doctrine, first of all, provides that three core values, fishing, navigation, and commerce, are to be protected for the public's benefit. The public trust doctrine ensures that these three uses are protected for navigable waters. And the public trust doctrine limits divestment or sale or transfer of public trust resources without proper public decision making. Now, one of the many questions you might be asking is what is proper public decision making, and that's definitely a topic we can explore. What I've just described about the public trust doctrine is well settled, well settled. And in fact, in the Great Lakes region, we have some of the strongest legal history to back it up. As both scholars, courts, and advocates will often point out, the public trust doctrine came to us with a long lineage dating back to the Institutes of Justinian under Roman law, through English common law, the equal footing doctrine passed through to the original 13 colonies. In the Great Lakes region, the Northwest Ordinance of 1787 specifically provides for a public trust doctrine for the Great Lakes and connecting waters. So all that's very well settled. And then in 1970, Joe Sachs, professor who was then at the University of Michigan, wrote quite a famous law review article that proposed a new application of the public trust doctrine. Keep in mind, in 1970, this was Earth Day, the emergence of environmental values, a new public concern for environmental protection. And Joe Sachs proposed using the public trust doctrine as a way to better protect the environment and natural resources. His article has received tremendous attention. From a nuts and bolts law professor perspective, you can only hope to write something that's cited as often as Joe's article. But it's not that straightforward. After Professor Sachs wrote his article in 1970, the world changed, or at least the world of environmental law changed. And Congress stepped in, and from the National Environmental Policy Act, I guess in December of 1969, through the Clean Air Act of 1970, and the amendments to the Federal Water Pollution Control Act, known as the Clean Water Act in 1972, Congress essentially rejected the idea of creating environmental rights administered through the courts, and instead developed a system based on reasonable utilization of natural resources, pollution with permits, and administration of environmental standards by government agencies. This is the world of environmental law that we know and practice today. Environmental law nowadays is essentially an outgrowth of the administrative state and the result of legislation. And this has left both advocates, courts, and scholars wondering what role there is now for the public trust doctrine, with lawmaking and administration being our primary way of protecting the environment. So I'm going to offer a few objective summaries of what I see are the ideas that have been put forward to continue to make the public trust doctrine relevant. And one of the things you could be thinking about today is whether you agree with these ideas. The first is that environmental advocates have tried to expand the public trust doctrine physically, both dealing with navigable waters, the boundaries of those navigable waters, high water marks, low water marks, definition of navigability, intrusions onto upland property, but also to more types of resources than may have been originally conceived for the public trust doctrine. The most notable, I think, right now is attempts to use the public trust doctrine to protect the atmosphere from climate change, viewing the atmosphere as part of our trust. Some of these efforts are well-grounded in settled law. Public trust doctrine has always applied to wildlife, fisheries, oyster beds. The air, there's a lot of historical support for applying the public trust doctrine to the air. But courts have had mixed feelings, frankly, about these litigation efforts. Second way environmentalists have looked to expand the public trust doctrine is conceptually. Environmental advocates have sought to use the public trust doctrine as a basis for environmental protection. So while the core public trust doctrine protected navigation, fishing, and commerce, environmental advocates have repeatedly, since Joe Sachs's article in 1970, sought to expand the use of the public trust doctrine to essentially create either a right to a healthy environment or an obligation by the trustees, the states, and perhaps the federal government to protect the environment. You could either think of this as an extension of ensuring navigation, fishing, and commerce, or perhaps for something more substantive that stands on its own two feet. The Mono Lake case is often cited as one of the leading examples of application of that extension, where the California Supreme Court charged the state of California and its Water Resources Board with ensuring environmental protection in its allocation of water use decisions under California's prior appropriation system. And finally, this is a brief summary, not comprehensive, but I'm trying to hit the high points. Environmental advocates have sought to use the public trust doctrine to ensure better, more open, more democratically accountable decision making for public trust resources. And actually, it's on this final point that I want to offer a few thoughts of my own. I've written extensively about the public trust doctrine, and I don't want to rehash much of that right now. Issues about whether the public trust doctrine should apply to groundwater, since it's not a navigable water body of water, but is connected to navigable bodies of water, how the public trust doctrine might operate on the shorelines, things like that. But I'd like to conclude with a few thoughts on how the public trust doctrine might better fit with our modern administrative environmental law state through steering us towards better environmental decision making. So most environmental decisions now are made by agencies. That's the reality we live in. And those agencies operate with authorizations from legislatures, Congress, via statutes, They exercise their discretion, they provide procedures, they make decisions, and by and large, courts defer to the agency's both process and substantive decisions. And at the end of the day, the reality is that agencies make environmental law. That's the reality, for better or for worse. Without actually saying whether it's for better or for worse, I'd put it this way. You'll get what we're getting. I think agency-made environmental law is going to produce exactly what you see around us today. A decent quality of the environment. Generally, the worst sources of pollution and most egregious harms to the environment are restricted. But we don't have anything approaching true sustainability. We haven't found a peace with nature. And we haven't really figured out how to make our personal and societal goals compatible with the limits of nature. That's a lot to ask of the public trust doctrine, but I have a few ideas that might help move things along. Three quick ones, and then I'm going to turn the podium over to Professor Huffman, Dean Huffman, who's got a lot to say about
this.
No one wants to hear from you too much. A few thoughts. So first of all, specific doctrinal ideas that I've been tossing around. The first is standing. Standing for, especially for the 1Ls in the room who aren't familiar with the concept, standing is a jurisdictional requirement through our Constitution adopted by the Supreme Court that provides that only cases or controversies may be heard by courts, and more specifically, that litigants, plaintiffs, must have suffered an injury caused by the actions of the defendant, susceptible to redress by the court in order for the court to hear the claim. As a practical matter, especially the causation requirement has made using the courts to address complex problems of environmental harm somewhere between difficult and impossible. Climate change is perhaps the most extreme example. You'd be hard-pressed to find any single source of global warming pollution that is causing climate change that would be redressed by a court. But on a system as large as the Great Lakes, you also see the same problem play out. It'd be very difficult, for example, to overcome standing hurdles to try to address a potential source of invasive species in the Great Lakes. There's literally thousands of sources of invasive species in the Great Lakes, and we often don't know which specific actor was the cause of which invasive species at which time. Standing thus creates a hurdle to using the courts to address environmental harms. This is neither a new observation on my part, nor anything that's not by design. I think that was, frankly, the intent. I guess what I'm looking to do is revisit that a little bit. Given that the public trust doctrine is our doctrine, and the public, and we are the public whose rights are protected and whose interests must be stewarded under the public trust doctrine, I would propose using the public trust doctrine as a basis for standing to allow individuals to seek review in courts, federal and state, of governmental decisions that have the potential to impact their public trust. And issue the three doctrinal hurdles of causation, injury, causation, and redressability could either be dealt with in a lawyerly fashion by saying essentially your injury is your public trust beneficiary has been injured, and the causation and redressability are functions of the government's exercise of its public trust duties. Or perhaps you might brush the standing doctrine as it's been applied aside and say this is a new basis for standing. Second idea I'm going to put on the table, due process. Due process, again, is a foundational constitutional issue. Due process essentially ensures that when you have property or liberty interests at stake, the government must provide you with an adequate process to ensure that your rights are protected. Not really talking about a substantive due process right here, but a procedural due process right. The right to go to court to have your interests heard and vindicated, and to ensure that the procedures used to reach a decision involving your rights and interests allows for things like our adversarial system, introduction of evidence, cross-examination, objective decision maker, things like that. Now, again, environmental issues have a very tough time getting through the due process doctrine, largely because, as you might imagine, the air above you, the Great Lakes that you enjoy, have not been traditionally recognized as either your liberty interest nor your personal property. And as those doctrines are defined, I guess I would agree. But the public trust doctrine could give us a new way of looking at due process. Public trust doctrine could be the basis to recognize that we have a public right on par with a private right that must be protected under due process. And keep in mind that your due process rights, while due process is a federal doctrine coming to us from the Fifth Amendment and applicable to states through the 14th Amendment, the definition of property protected by the due process has been left by federal courts to state law. Federal courts have been very deferential to state law to shape and define what is your property right that the federal Constitution protects. So as states move further along in developing and applying their public trust doctrine, it might be appropriate for federal courts to recognize state public trust rights on par with your state property rights and your liberty interests that must be protected by due process. Third, and this is, I think, perhaps the most important, I don't know if it'll be the most controversial, you guys will tell me, or I'll test it in court and find out. Standards of review. Sorry to keep sounding like a lawyer, but this is really how decisions get made. It's all about standards of review. When that agency makes a decision to, say, allow development of a water resource or pollution of your air, shorelines, what have you, as a practical matter, the standards of review make it very difficult to overcome the agency's decision. To use the specific doctrines, if the agency is, of course, proposing a rule, Chevron applies. But even more broadly, generally speaking, agencies are subject only to an arbitrary and capricious standard, a highly deferential standard of review. And for reasons of both separation of powers and agency expertise, courts show agencies tremendous deference. I would suggest that this third doctrine of deference should be revisited under the public trust doctrine. The agencies, as they've developed in the past now 40 years, are not the trustees of the public trust doctrine. The democratically elected legislatures are. Congress, or your state legislature. And especially when you're dealing with the question of separation of powers, when you're dealing with the separation of powers as the basis for deferring to an agency instead of having the court make a decision de novo, the public trust doctrine, I think, shakes that assumption up quite a bit. Frankly, the public trust doctrine never empowered agencies to be the decision makers for the allocation and stewardship of our natural resources. That's left with our democratic institutions. And the public trust doctrine might be the basis for cutting back on the deference to agencies and requiring agencies both substantively to apply the acts and statutes of Congress and the legislatures in a way that furthers the public trust doctrine and respects it, and removes almost the blank check of deference that agencies have to all but rewrite the laws of Congress based on their expertise or their practical considerations or, yes, their political agenda. This would really change the game in environmental law. Instead of having our current system of environmental law where Congress does the most minimal work, legislatures do the most minimal work, basically putting forward aspirations and goals for environmental protection, generally identifying harms and empowering an agency to go about it, this would shift a lot of the environmental decision-making back to courts. Now, we could have an entire discussion today, and maybe much of discussion today will focus on whether that's a good idea. Because at the end of the day, most of the proposals you're going to hear about using the public trust doctrine inherently suggest that courts, rather than agencies, should be making our environmental decisions. So maybe that's a question you want to consider as you're hearing the other presentations. Anyway, I'm going to wrap up. That's I think I put enough on the table for right now. Again, I really want to, I can't say enough about the lineup of folks coming up here. I've known many of them for years, and my thinking has benefited tremendously. Just to give you a preview, Dean Huffman is one of the leading scholars on the public trust doctrine and has often provided a very critical and historically grounded view of modern application of the public trust doctrine. I have to give a nod to Professor Scanlon. Her idea of using the public trust doctrine to create a Great Lakes Water Trail is one of the most exciting things I've come across in this business in a while. And more specifically, she's done amazing work both on the ground interviewing the trustees who do the day-to-day work administering the public trust doctrine and looking at how the public trust doctrine should operate across the Great Lakes region. And Professor Kilbert has done a lot of work on public trust doctrine on shorelines. My colleague Nick Schreck is going to be talking about public trust doctrine and the new issue of microplastics. And finally, I really want to give a tremendous nod to Jim Olson. Without the benefit of an academic position, tenure, and a lovely government salary, Jim Olson has spent his career, and I use career loosely, I probably should say his life, working to enforce the public trust doctrine and make Michigan's air, water, and natural resources better as a result of it. I really don't know anybody who's given as much of his life to an issue as Jim Olson has. The work he's done is really inspiring. With that, I'm going to turn it over. Thank you guys very much. Have a great day.
This is a new experience for me. Usually students are walking out when I get up to talk. First, I want to thank the people here at Detroit who have arranged this. Justin was very proficient in getting things put together, was in regular and always informative contact. This is the first time in my life I've been picked up by the editor-in-chief and the executive editor of the Law Review at the airport, so I thank you for that. And it's great. I've known Jackie for many years, and now I've seen her in her natural habitat, so it's great to finally see you where you work. And the other preliminary, I want to apologize to the panelists this afternoon. I'm not leaving because I'm disinterested. My son is in a play at Kenyon College this evening, and he said I should be there, so I will be there. And that requires me to leave right after lunch. Noah was generous in his observations about me. My colleague, Mike Blum, has long called me the Darth Vader of the public trust doctrine, and said I'm kind of like a skunk at a lawn party. I will, in a way, play that role, but I hope in a constructive way, because I think that the public trust doctrine is a powerful but very limited doctrine if we're true to its common law and historical roots. First, why is the public trust doctrine such a popular topic? Noah says it's been written about endlessly, and that is absolutely true. I mean, there are literally thousands of articles on the public trust doctrine. And I haven't written all of them. I've written only 5 or 6. There's lots of people working on this subject. And why is that appeal so broad? Well, I think it's partly because of the nature of the problems that we're dealing with, whether it's on the Great Lakes or any place else in this country or in the world, for that matter. It's a theme that one can hear and read about in a lot of other countries. And these are complex problems, problems that impact a lot of people, and problems that that go across boundaries, political boundaries, jurisdictional boundaries, and it's kind of has a natural appeal. The idea that there's a public trust, that the public has rights rooted in a trust of some kind that might help us solve these problems. So I understand that appeal. I think it also is because of a strong sense among many environmental advocates that legislatures have failed and the executive branches have failed. Certainly if you read a lot of the public trust arguments with respect to climate change in the atmosphere, and Mary Wood, who's the principal proponent of the atmospheric trust theory, is very explicit about it. She says the problem is that legislatures and executives have failed and somebody's got to do something, so let's look to the courts. So, and I understand that, although I disagree with it from a principled constitutional separation of powers point of view. And lastly, I think the doctrine has appeal, although it's not often articulated, because it is a way of dealing with these takings, constitutional takings issues that always exist in the background of environmental regulation, because environmental regulation, however it is imposed, is going to impact on private property rights. And depending on how courts interpret the takings clause, it can have significant consequences and operate as a significant constraint on regulation. And for reasons that are pretty straightforward, the public trust doctrine is sort of a magic bullet, because by its very nature, the public trust doctrine predates any existing property right. That's the foundation of the doctrine. It is, as Noah said, it's a limit. It functions as a limit on property rights, and that's absolutely true. It's well, among those things that Justice Scalia called background principles in a takings case back a couple decades. And so if you can establish that the public trust operates as a limit on a property right, then there's no taking, because the right never existed in the first place, and you can't take something that somebody never had. So the appeal of it in that sense is very powerful. Well, I would suggest these are all reasons that I can even get behind, but I'm a lawyer, a dedicated rule of law guy, and I think it's very problematic to get the public trust doctrine to do what many people, I think, today will argue that it should do, and certainly many people have argued in the general literature that it should do. The doctrine is, let me just give you a few historical references. I wrote a way too long article with way too many footnotes that appeared in the Duke Environmental Law and Policy Journal in 2007 that details the history of the public trust doctrine. But basically, most modern day advocates just get the history wrong. They're just making it up. And it really starts with a thing by Jan Stevens, who wrote a piece in the journal Davis Law Review in 1980, one of the early symposiums. Joe Sachs was there and a lot of other people. And it starts, for example, with the reference to Justinian. And if you've read anything about the public trust doctrine, you've read this quote by Justinian. Things common to mankind by the law of nature are the air, running water, the sea, and consequently the shores of the sea. Well, if you know anything, or just a little bit about Roman law, you'll know that that reference really has nothing to do with the modern concept of the public trust doctrine. There was no idea of trust. There was no idea of public rights. And if you read, when you see that quote, if it's properly done, there are three ellipses at the end, or that isn't an ellipse, I guess, at the end, three dots, which are never included in the quote.
And what did those three dots say? Well, they said, let me repeat the first part so you have it in your mind. Things common to mankind by the law of nature are the air, running water, the sea, and consequently the shores of the sea, whilst he abstains from damaging farms, monuments, and buildings which are not in common as the sea is. In other words, it was perfectly possible in a Roman law, and Justinian recognized it, for the seashore to be privately owned, and it was privately owned, and in extensive amounts, and for the same purposes that we might make it privately owned today. And yet the Justinian principle is often quoted in the context of saying that the state cannot alienate any of the public trust lands. And I'll get to Illinois Central in a moment, which also doesn't say what people usually say it says. Well, I could say a lot more about Roman law, but you're probably not very interested. Enough to say it isn't a good foundation for basing modern public trust law because it's simply the claims that are made are simply wrong. Magna Carta, to jump forward a little more than 1,000 years, is similarly, I think, misapplied. There are two provisions in Magna Carta that are said to be foundational of the public trust doctrine. One was chapter 16, which said, no riverbank shall be placed in defense from henceforth, except such as were so placed in the time of King Henry, our grandfather, by the same places and the same bounds as they were wont to be in his time. Well, that is taken to mean that there ought to be public access to these riverbanks. Well, it is absolutely true that King Henry and his predecessors limited access to the banks for their own private, personal, proprietary purposes. Bear in mind that the Magna Carta was an agreement between the barons and the king. So it was really a dispute about who got to have exclusive access, not whether you and me and everybody else wandering the Isle of Great Britain would have access to it. And the other provision is chapter 23, which provides all weirs for the future shall be utterly put down on the Thames and Medway and throughout all England except on the seashore. Well, once again, the problem was that the king was putting weirs in the rivers to trap fish, and the barons objected to that, and they got him to agree otherwise. So the Magna Carta really has nothing to do with the modern concept of public rights in resources. What was the English rule? Well, the English rule was foundational to modern and 19th century American public trust law. It was a very limited rule. But the origins of that rule are very interesting. It's often said that the law of England provided a prima facie, that the ownership of the beds of navigable streams was prima facie in the crown. Now, where did that rule come from? Well, it came from a clever lawyer working on behalf of the king, who was trying to overcome the fact that there were all kinds of private claims to submerged lands under navigable waters where the claimant had no demonstrated title. It was may have been in their ownership for 100 years or so, they thought, but the prima facie rule was introduced as a rule of evidence to say if it is in the crown unless you can demonstrate otherwise. So it put the burden on the claimants to demonstrate ownership and not otherwise. That rule, which was a rule of evidence, has today become viewed as a rule of title, that the title is prima facie in the state or in the crown, as the predecessors said. Well, I can say a lot more about English law, but time doesn't allow, so let me jump to American law, which is, as you all know, being good law students, was English law was received into the American colonies when they were first settled in this country, and then later when they became independent, it was received into the states. What did that mean? It just meant that whatever the law of England was going to be the law here unless it was changed, anticipating that there would be significant changes. Well, so we inherited whatever the public trust doctrine was at the time in this country, and the one major change that was made to the English law was with respect to what constituted navigability, although there's a debate about what constituted navigable waters. Although there is debate about whether the English rule is what it is often said to have been, which is that navigability equated with title, T-I-D-A-L, and that the, so that navigable waters in Great Britain were those which were tidal, affected by the tides. Now that would cover almost all navigable waters in Great Britain by the nature of the geography and the topography, right? In this country, not so. We've got the Mississippi, the Ohio, the Missouri, all kinds of rivers that are clearly navigable for commercial purposes, but are not affected by the tides. And very early American courts made that modification, if indeed it was a modification at all. And as I say, there's some debate about whether or not similar non-tidal navigable waters in Britain were also said to be affected by the public trust. But that was the major change, and it was a change clearly consistent with the purposes of the doctrine, which were, and I agree fully with Noah's description of it, that is, it had to do with navigation, commerce, and fishing. You find an occasional case that references bathing, but it was really commercial navigation, and fishing were the rights that were protected. And so when the American rule, the English rule was adapted to the American topography, it extended the reach of that, those fishing and navigation, commercial navigation rights, to waters that were clearly navigable, in fact, but were non-tidal waters. Okay, so that's what we got. We got a doctrine which is very clearly and narrowly, not insignificantly, but narrowly defined as commercial navigation, fishing, maybe bathing. I'm willing to keep it in there because a few courts said so. And it applied to waters that were navigable in fact, which included some non-tidal waters. Well, the American case law, early American case law on the public trust doctrine is fairly limited, but it's kind of interesting. And the ones that are most cited tend to be, I'll mention four, there are others, three, and one that's never mentioned. First was Arnold against Mundy, which was a case involving title to oyster beds and who had the exclusive right or not, and could the state grant an exclusive right to the oyster beds in New Jersey. It's a complicated historical record, sort of chain of title with respect to these lands, but Arnold v. Mundy basically said that the state couldn't grant title to an individual to oyster beds. What is almost never mentioned is that Arnold against Mundy was overturned in Gow against Bell about 29 years later on the very foundation that the dissenting judge in Arnold against Mundy said it was wrong to begin with, which was there were all kinds of private ownership of oyster beds and submerged lands in New Jersey. It had been that way. The state statute explicitly authorized it, including a statute adopted immediately prior to and another one adopted after Arnold against Mundy. The court was simply wrong about what the law of New Jersey was, and finally that same court in 1850 recognized that and overturned Arnold against Mundy. But you will never see Gow against Bell cited, and you will see Arnold against Mundy cited as if nobody shepherdizes cases today, but in my day you shepherdized cases, which meant you figured out which ones had been overturned, and you would find out that Arnold against Mundy is not good law in New Jersey and hasn't been for now 165 years. The second case that's often cited is Martin against Waddell, which is a United States Supreme Court case, and it relied heavily on Arnold in making its decision. But what's interesting about Martin against Waddell is that the two parties were both private claimants, and yet the court proceeds as if they're protecting a public right against the alienation to a private party, but the other side of the case was another private claimant. It was just a question of which private claimant had the better right. And then, of course, the case that anybody knows, any of these cases that you probably know, is Illinois Central, which has direct implications for the Great Lakes. And Illinois Central is foundational, to be sure, but also often misinterpreted. And I won't go on at length about how it is. If you want to really understand why Illinois Central has been misinterpreted, you should read an article by Joseph Kearney and Thomas Merrill, which appeared in the University of Chicago Law Review, volume 71, page 799, called The Origins of the American Public Trust Doctrine, What Really Happened in Illinois Central. And to get to the bottom line, what really happened in Illinois Central was not that the United States Supreme Court said that you could not alienate any submerged lands that were subject to the public trust. What they said is, you cannot alienate the entire lakeshore of the city of Chicago in a way that makes the public rights, that violates those public rights. But can you alienate individual parcels? Absolutely. It happened before, it happened after, it continues to happen. And there's a broad view that the public trust doctrine prohibits the alienation of so-called public trust lands, submerged lands. And that is just, that is not true, never has been true in the law of this country, or the law of Romans, if you want to go back that far, or the laws of England. Well, to the Great Lakes, what is the implication? Why is this seen as a sort of a new way to protect the interests that people have in the ecological environmental resources of the Great Lakes? Well, I think that the doctrine is very powerful if it's applied to its common law origins, which is fishing, navigation, access for those purposes on navigable waters, and there's nobody doubting that the Great Lakes are not navigable. So the issue, and if you look at the case law, I'm not nearly as expert as most of the people here on the Great Lakes case law, but I've looked at enough of it to say, it seems like much of the early case law, the debate was about what's the boundary? Is it the high water mark? Where is the high water mark? And we've got 8 states you're dealing with. You might get 8 different answers to that. But those are the issues, and those are legitimate issues. Those are issues that need to be answered. And there's a lot of power that can be derived from that principle, that traditional common law principle about the public trust doctrine. I'm not going to review the case law, although what I've seen of the case law and what I know, I am indebted to Jim Olson more than anybody because I read his article, and he does a nice job of summarizing that case law on a state-by-state basis. And I don't find much in that case law to disagree with. I think the state courts of these 8 states have been pretty allegiant to the common law public trust doctrine. There are a few exceptions, most notably in my judgment, in Wisconsin, and that's a fairly old case, just against Marinette County, where I think they wandered far from the common law foundations. But let me make an observation about how we've gotten to this point today where there's all kinds of ambition to try to make the public trust doctrine do a lot of stuff that it did not do in its common law history. Noah mentioned Joe Sachs's article, hugely influential. That article is cited more than the 100 articles I've written, all put together have been cited. It's phenomenal, the impact that that article had. What Noah didn't mention was Joe wrote another article. It was published, I think about 10 years later, actually. And the title of it was Liberating the Public Trust Doctrine from Its Historical Shackles. Well, what were the historical shackles? They were the common law. They were all the things I've just been talking about. The doctrine just didn't do what Joe in his 1970 article suggested that it might be able to do. And the only way to get the doctrine to do what Joe Sachs argued in 1970 that it should do was to find courts who were willing to be creative, let's say, and greatly expand the reach of the doctrine. That's what liberating it from its historical shackles meant. It means that the damn doctrine doesn't do what we want it to do because these common law courts had a very narrow view of what it was about. So let's try to expand it. And there's kind of 4 paths that have been used to do that, and this sort of parallels at least part of what Noah Hall said. One is to expand the geographical scope. That is, if it applies to just the navigable waters, either we expand our definition of what constitutes navigable waters, or we say, well, yeah, but there's a lot of waters that impact on navigable waters, and we can extend it to them. A good example is the state of Montana, which basically every drop of water in the state of Montana is subject to the public trust doctrine on the theory that all those little drops of water contribute to eventually the Missouri River, and that's clearly navigable, and therefore everything's navigable, or at least therefore affected by the public trust. So that's one pathway, and a few courts have accepted that as a way of expanding it. The second is to expand the protected uses. Now, I agree with most of what Noah said, but I'm a little doubtful about the generalized reference to wildlife as always protected by the public trust doctrine. I think it was fishing. Whether the deer that roam the streets of Detroit, I assume you have deer in Detroit like we do in Portland, are protected by the public trust, I'm a little more skeptical of that. But that's another avenue that is argued before a lot of courts. Let's expand the uses. And of course, the most ambitious of all such arguments is that put forward by Mary Wood for the expansion of into the so-called atmospheric trust. The third way that it's been argued that it could be expanded is one I've already mentioned, that is to claim that the doctrine prohibits alienation. It clearly did not historically, which isn't to say a court can't say it does, but there's nothing in the historical roots of the public trust doctrine saying that the state cannot alienate those resources unless it alienates them to such an extent and in such a manner that it basically makes the public rights unusable. And lastly, and this is the most problematic in my view in the modern case law, is to really conflate the public trust doctrine with the police power or with the general ideas of public right. And where I've complimented Jim's article, now I'll be critical of Jim's article in the Vermont Law Review, is Jim takes a very, very broad idea of what the public trust doctrine is and finds it rooted in a lot of statutes and constitutions and so forth. And I think that's a confusion of the traditional public, the police power that the state has to regulate in the public interest and the narrow idea of public rights rooted in the public trust doctrine. Well, in the interest of time, I'm going to try to wrap this up so that Alexis doesn't feel like her former dean has pulled rank on her. But I think that this latter problem of confusing the public trust doctrine with with other doctrines that relate to the public interest, and maybe the best way to make that point is to say that there is in democratic government, we trust that the democracy will act in our interest. That's a very different kind of trust than we're talking about under the public trust doctrine. The public trust doctrine is a very defined concept of trust in traditional trust law understanding. And that's a very different thing from trusting that government will serve the public interest. Certainly government has a responsibility to serve the public interest, but if it does not, are the courts the place to get remedies? And I would say no. The last place we want to go is to the court. There's a reason that we have standing rules that make it difficult for generalized grievances to be taken to the courts, and that's because courts are not a good place to solve them. They're not institutionally structured for that. They're constitutionally prohibited from that, at least as I read the American Constitution. And the courts is really the last place we want to solve these problems. And if we can't get the legislatures and the executive to do what we think they should do, well, we're losing in the political game, but that's the way this separation of power system of ours is meant to operate. So with that, I will conclude by saying I'm not Darth Vader. I'm very sympathetic with the objectives of environmental advocates. I think that the public trust path is not a promising path. And I think what courts have done in response to these claims largely confirms that I'm right about that. Courts have not been very receptive to these ambitious claims. There are examples. There's a recent case in the Dutch lower courts of Holland saying that there's something sort of like the public trust doctrine. They attributed to a whole lot of stuff in generalized principles of international law, they say, that gives the court the right to order the government of the Netherlands to implement laws that they have chosen not to implement because they didn't think it was good policy. When courts are put in that position, we're living in a different world than I thought we were, at least under the American Constitution. So thank you very much.
Well, good morning. I think I might need a little bit more of an introduction than some of the other speakers, so I'll let you know that my name is Alexis Hanneman. I'm a graduate fellow attorney at the Conservation Law Center, which is a small nonprofit firm that operates the Environmental Law Clinic at Indiana University's Maurer School of Law. And I'm going to speak a little bit about recent and, in fact, ongoing public trust litigation concerning the extent of Indiana citizens' rights along the state's Lake Michigan shoreline, as well as a little bit about the history of Indiana's public trust doctrine. And I'm especially glad to have the opportunity to discuss this litigation with students, now a few less students, but students nonetheless. The idea for this presentation grew from a disconnect that I noticed between the public trust doctrine that I studied as a law student and the public trust doctrine that I encountered as a practicing attorney. As many of you are aware, and certainly you're aware now, if you were not already, for over four decades, the public trust doctrine has attracted attention from concerned citizens, state governments, and especially legal scholars who are looking for a method to protect communally valuable natural resources. And during this time, a flood of public trust scholarship has given rise to a consistent academic narrative. Professor Huffman has already called this history into question, but according to the narrative, the public trust doctrine first emerged in ancient Roman and medieval English common law before passing to the original 13 states after the American Revolution and ultimately spreading across the country as an incident of statehood. Traditionally, and at its core, the public trust doctrine preserves citizens' rights to use navigable water bodies and submerged lands below the ordinary high water mark for commerce, navigation, and fishing. But scholars have largely left that traditional doctrine behind. According to the academic narrative, the public trust doctrine, as we've heard, has shaken off its historical shackles and now promises to embrace 21st century environmental ideals, including the preservation of aesthetic and ecological values in a wide variety of natural resources, farther and farther removed from the beds of navigable water bodies, such as dry sand beaches, state parks, and even the electromagnetic spectrum. And as you've also heard already, recently proponents of a legal strategy known as atmospheric trust litigation have invoked the public trust doctrine in their effort to halt climate change by forcing reductions in global greenhouse gas emissions. The academic narrative is enticing. But reliance on public trust law as a tool to address diverse resource management problems is more complicated than it might initially appear. The reason for that is that there is no uniform, universal public trust doctrine. Instead, each state applies a slightly different interpretation of the doctrine's purpose and geographic scope. And unfortunately, in emphasizing expansion, the optimistic academic narrative doesn't accurately reflect the public trust doctrine as it exists in many states, including several in the Great Lakes region, where the extent and enforceability of the traditional public trust doctrine remains quite controversial. That is, the doctrine as it pertains to navigable water bodies and submerged lands below the ordinary high water mark. In recent years, the gulf between the academic narrative and judicial reality has grown ever wider. In certain states, proponents of expansive private property rights have begun to challenge core public trust protections in court. While many scholars continue to focus primarily on creative, innovative, and potentially quite remote applications of the doctrine. To illustrate this divide, I'd like to briefly review several components of the public trust doctrine as it exists in Indiana. Examining state legislation and early case law reveals that Indiana once enjoyed a fairly robust public trust doctrine, but it was never fully developed. Beginning around 1950, advocates and legislatures began to turn their attention elsewhere, leaving many questions about the extent and the enforceability of the doctrine unanswered. Recent challenges to core public trust protections in Indiana demonstrate the perils of this neglect, and the possibility of reviving, strengthening, and gradually expanding underdeveloped doctrines through careful lawyering. By necessity, public trust scholars focus on arguments and explanations that are general and mask the specific details, that is, both the specific strengths and the specific vulnerabilities of the public trust doctrine as it exists in individual states. Indiana's example is a valuable counterpoint to the academic narrative for two reasons. First, it demonstrates the danger of emphasizing innovative applications of the doctrine to the exclusion of the core protections. Reliance on the robust academic conversation concerning the public trust might lead some advocates to focus their efforts solely on expansion. But as the recent litigation in Indiana demonstrates, it would be a mistake to take core public trust protections on faith. Second, although the specific details of one state's public trust law might hold little promise for academics, these existing public trust protections can provide a foundation and a blueprint for further expansion. So, begin by highlighting some Indiana case law that, at first glance, appears consistent with the academic narrative. Specifically, the cases I'm going to talk about confirm the existence of core public trust protections, and in them, the courts indicate a willingness to expand the doctrine's reach. So in Sherlock v. Bainbridge, the Indiana Supreme Court considered a dispute that arose between a shoreline business owner and several commercial vessels on the Ohio River, which is a navigable water body and therefore a core public trust resource. The court confirmed that the commercial vessel's right to navigate the Ohio, and therefore the public's rights in navigable water bodies, were superior to a riparian landowner's right to maintain his wharf free from damage caused by passing vessels. In recognizing the public's paramount right to navigate and carry out commerce on a navigable river, the Indiana Supreme Court acknowledged the existence of core trust protections in a traditional resource. And in addition, by acknowledging the existence of certain rights incident to navigation, the court indicated a possible willingness to expand the category of activities protected under the public trust doctrine. Nearly 60 years later, the Indiana Court of Appeals confirmed that the public's rights extended to the bed of Lake Michigan, another core public trust resource, and indicated that the state, as a sovereign entity with public trust responsibilities, lacked authority to alienate that resource. In 1950, the Indiana Supreme Court, this time, acknowledged that the state had obtained title to the beds of navigable water bodies. In this instance, the court was referring to the White River, which you can see a little bit on the back of that slide. Upon admission to the Union in 1816, and once again, an Indiana court indicated that the public trust doctrine limited Indiana's ability to alienate these resources. And most recently, in 2013, 63 years after Kivett was decided, the United States District Court for the Northern District of Indiana clearly identified the landward boundary of the public's rights in the bed of Lake Michigan. So as I mentioned at first glance, each of these cases appears to confirm the academic narrative surrounding the public trust doctrine. Upon admission to the Union, each state obtained title to the beds of the navigable water bodies within its borders, that is the Ohio River, the White River, and Lake Michigan in Indiana, to be held in trust for the public. The public's rights included navigation, sand and gravel mining, which were the activities at issue in Lake Sand and Kivett. And as the Indiana Supreme Court indicated in Sherlock in 1872, potentially other rights related to those. So far, so good in Indiana. But each of these cases also reveals a vulnerability in Indiana's core public trust doctrine. Although courts make clear that the state holds the beds of navigable water bodies in trust for the public, there's no reliable statement indicating where on the shore the public's rights end and private property begins. For example, in 1837, the Indiana Supreme Court determined that private property on the Ohio River extended to the river's low water mark, because the low water mark of the Ohio River is also the southern boundary of the state. In Sherlock, the Indiana Supreme Court expressed reluctance to overturn that rule, which had become a settled rule of property on the Ohio River, but indicated that it might set the property boundary at the ordinary high water mark, were the issue an original and open one? In Lake Sand, the parties conceded the existence of the public trust doctrine and its applicability to the bed of Lake Michigan. And both Lake Sand and Kivett simply refer to the beds of navigable water bodies without defining the boundaries of public rights. Finally, in Carstens, the federal court's clear statement concerning the public trust boundary appears to actually just be a product of the academic narrative itself. The state of Indiana wasn't a party in this case, and the court identified the ordinary high watermark as the boundary of public rights in reliance on authorities that don't clearly support that rule at all. So although these cases appear at first glance to support the academic narrative, upon further inspection, they actually reveal a vulnerability in Indiana's trust law that advocates of extensive private property rights would later seek to exploit. There's no clear rule designating the boundary of public rights on Lake Michigan's shore. Like the state's common law, the Indiana Code also diverges from the academic narrative concerning the public trust doctrine. Since 1947, Indiana's Lake Preservation Act has protected public rights in lakes. Specifically, the law declares that natural resources and the natural scenic beauty of Indiana are public rights. It indicates that the public has a vested right in the preservation, protection, and recreational use of public freshwater lakes. And the act employs express trust language in describing the state's responsibilities with respect to those resources. Because the Lakes Preservation Act applies to both meandered and unmeandered lakes, that is, navigable and non-navigable water bodies, as well as fish, plant life, and minerals, it represents an expansion of the corpus of the traditional public trust doctrine. And in this way, the Lakes Preservation Act demonstrates a specific strength of Indiana's trust law. That is, a foundation for the expansion of the doctrine to include additional public uses. But again, there's a downside. The act expressly does not apply to Lake Michigan, and it fails to address the vulnerability concerning the boundary of public rights that's apparent in the case law. So in April 2014, a Lake Michigan homeowner sought to capitalize on the vulnerabilities in Indiana's public trust doctrine by filing suit against the state, claiming that he was the exclusive owner of the entirety of the Lake Michigan beach between his home and the water's edge. In other words, the homeowner argued that Indiana citizens possess no right to use any portion of Lake Michigan's exposed shore. Last July, LaPorte County Judge Richard Stahlberg rejected this claim. And the judge followed US Supreme Court precedent, setting the boundary of public rights at the ordinary high watermark, and concluded that the public's rights below the ordinary high watermark include navigation, fishing, commerce, recreation, and all other activities related thereto, including but not limited to boating, swimming, sunbathing, and other beach sport activities. In the event that private property extends below Lake Michigan's ordinary high watermark on the Lake Michigan shore, Judge Stahlberg made clear that the public's rights are paramount. And the judge concluded his opinion with powerful language in support of public rights. He says, "To hold otherwise would invite the creation of a beach landscape dotted with small, private, fenced, and fortified compounds designed to deny the public from enjoying Indiana's limited access to one of the greatest natural resources in the state." So on the whole, the Gunderson case is a positive result for Indiana citizens and public trust advocates. In identifying the boundary of public rights on Lake Michigan's shore, Judge Stahlberg began to resolve a critical vulnerability in Indiana's trust law. And I'll say a little bit more about that in just a moment. In addition, by extending public trust protection to encompass recreational uses, the judge capitalized on Indiana trust law's specific strength, that is, the expansive description of protected activities already present in the state's statutory law in the Lakes Preservation Act. But again, there is a downside here. Judge Solbrink chose to adopt Indiana's administrative ordinary high water mark rather than the natural ordinary high water mark as the boundary of public rights. And that's concerning for several reasons. First, the Indiana Department of Natural Resources can relocate the administrative ordinary high water mark by regulation. So in other words, the agency could essentially decide to eliminate all public rights with very little fanfare. Second, the administrative ordinary high water mark is set at a boundary or at an elevation of 581.5 feet. And in practice, the Department of Natural Resources estimates that that boundary falls about 17 feet from the water's edge on the Lake Michigan shore. So although Indiana citizens now have the right to sunbathe and engage in all manner of beach sports, they actually have a very narrow strip of sand in which they can carry out those activities. Finally, to the extent to which the administrative ordinary high water mark falls lakeward of the natural ordinary high water mark, Judge Solbrink appears to have authorized the state to convey or curtail citizens' rights in the Lake Michigan shore, despite the Indiana Courts of Appeals' prohibition on doing exactly that in Lake Sand. And in so doing, the judge created a vulnerability where there had once been a strength in Indiana law. So, to conclude, a person relying on the academic narrative alone might not have realized that Indiana trust law's failure to identify the boundary of public rights on the Lake Michigan shore constituted a serious vulnerability in the state's public trust doctrine. And likewise, someone unfamiliar with the Indiana code might not have assumed that the state was ready to embrace recreational activities as protected public trust uses, or guessed that the law provides a similar foundation for the protection of aesthetic values. So, although it's a little bit less exciting than some of the proposals advanced in the academic narrative, these protections are vital to Indiana citizens who, as Judge Solbrink observed, have very little Lake Michigan shoreline to protect and enjoy. So, it's worth taking a close look.
Our speakers to come up to the table to take questions, and at the same time also feel free to question each other too. You can have an internal conversation with this part as well. So I'll perhaps start the question off in terms of one of the things that I was interested, Noah, in terms of your vision of change. My sense is that you and Jim have a different idea as to where the law should go, but I'm very interested in, given particularly on issues of standing and deference, what's actually happening on the ground now, to sort of move to Alex's narrative of the dissonance, but you're also an experienced practitioner, how do you see the best strategy to get there, and what are the main roadblocks?
Sure. So. I guess I'd make this observation from both Jim and Alexis's presentation. So to be really specific, I think it's fair to say, and of course tell me if I'm stating his position, that he and I have maybe at the core somewhat fundamentally different views of how separation of powers and role of courts should play out for environmental decision making. But it's not that black and white. One of the final points that Alexis closed with from the Indiana case is the question of defining the ordinary high water mark. So I think it's a way to take some of Jim and I's kind of general theoretical points, we could look at it through this specific question. And the Indiana court was reluctant, I think she was fair to criticize the Indiana court for adopting the administrative definition of the ordinary high water mark. In Michigan, we had a very different example in a case that I was involved in and litigated, the Glass versus Gecko case, which addressed the exact same questions in Michigan. And lawyers forever hold a grudge against a judge who doesn't fully buy their argument. So I'd say that we won about 90% of that case, but the one point, and in that case, Glass versus Gecko, the Michigan Supreme Court set the ordinary high water mark as the upward limit of the public trust. trust, the overlapping just publicum, exactly as Alex pointed out, happened in Indiana. One interesting side note, though, that's relevant to all this. The little piece that I lost in that case was I had urged the court to adopt the Michigan legislature's definition of the ordinary high water mark. In Michigan, we have the Great Lakes Submerged Lands Act with a definition which delineates the ordinary high water mark at a specific elevation using Corps of Engineer data. And I thought that using the legislative determination of the ordinary high water mark was both appropriate and practically beneficial, given that Michigan has, what, 3,200 miles or something of Great Lake, what's it? 2,200 miles of Great Lake. Sorry, I have to ask the person from Wisconsin that. I'm not really from Michigan, I've been here for 10 years. And I always have one foot out of there anyway. But we have thousands of miles of Great Lake shoreline in Michigan, and what the Michigan court adopted instead, going against Wisconsin, is the Wisconsin common law definition of the ordinary high water mark. So what does this mean for us? I want to now focus this back down. You have three ways for this specific example of deciding where the ordinary high water mark is. You could have a judicial common law definition, which Wisconsin has used and Michigan has adopted, and it ends up being a site-specific determination. You could have a statutory definition enacted by the legislature, and you could have an administrative determination. So in thinking about separation of powers and courts as decision makers, it's not actually a simple black and white decision. In fact, you have a range of choices. And I would agree with Alexis that leaving it up to an administrative agency is an improper delegation of the public trust doctrine. But I would stubbornly hold to what I suggested to the Michigan Supreme Court, and they didn't buy that part, that a legislative determination would be appropriate. And in fact, that's the proper balance between Jim's concerns of having environmental decisions made by courts and Alexis's concerns of having public trust doctrine improperly delegated to administrative agencies. You let the legislature decide. And of course, the legislature's decision is subject to the public trust doctrine, just as it was in Illinois Central, as a legislative determination, subject to federal review of the public trust doctrine. And I think in that way you would get the benefit of uniformity, predictability, and kind of a clear rule for landowners, which the Indiana court wanted, without the improper delegation authority to an administrative agency. So,
anybody want to jump in?
No, I would say a couple of things. One, I think that there's nothing special about environmental decision making compared to any other policy decision. So if we're going to buy the argument that the courts ought to play an instrumental role or a leading role in environmental decision making, I think we have to buy that for everything. And that, I do think, is a fundamental change in the nature of our system. Secondly, I would say that if you look at this from the point of view of private property owners, and we shouldn't forget about private property owners in this country because they own vast amounts of property. They are basically the driving force of the economy and provide for the kinds of good things that we have by the incentives they have to invest and use their property. What we don't want are property rights that are highly contingent. And I think a system in which the courts are free to change the rules as they perceive public necessity to change, or for the legislature to do that, or for the administrators to do that, makes the property rights contingent. And that is not, nor it's not a constitutional, in my judgment, under the Takings Clause or due process clause, nor is it good public policy because it leads to disincentives to good use of property. So when my colleague, Mike Blum, who was the best man at my wedding, by the way, although next time I'm married, he won't be. He's a very close friend, and Mike and I disagree about virtually everything. But Mike's response to my position is, well, the common law has always worked by judges adapting the law to changing circumstances. I think that that's not an accurate description of the way the common law worked. The best description of the way it worked, in my judgment, was one that has been argued by a couple of thoughtful scholars, where they just use economic lingo, they distinguish the demand side from the supply side views of the common law. The demand side is that, that the users of the law, consumers of the law, you and me, the property owners, the environmentalists, all those people, they make demands on the law, and when those demands are sufficiently widespread, and we know that, for example, when they're contracting around rules, then courts have historically made them. The supply side is rooted in the idea that judges are somehow better at determining what's in the public interest than our legislators or administrators. And I think that's just wrong. I think institutionally they're not designed for it. There's nothing special about judges, except that they have a lot more independence, which makes them a lot more dangerous if we give them those kinds of powers. So I'm sympathetic with not giving it. I'm with you on the legislative part of making these judgments. And if you've got administrative agencies running amok, that's as bad as courts running amok in a constitutional democracy.
Questions? Yes.
If we're afraid of courts running amok and the government running amok, how do we strike a balance between the two to decide who should make determinations on the public trust act?
Well, that's just me. I'd say if the public trust doctrine is understood to be what it historically was and continues largely to be, I'm not in the spirit at all with Alexis about resolving these disputes about the high or low watermark, whatever it is. Those are questions that the traditional public trust doctrine puts before us and properly before courts. But if we're looking at public trust doctrine to solve climate change, I think under the Constitution of this country and of every state in this country, that is the decision that belongs in the legislative body, government, not in the courts.
So I would just add a little, maybe disagree with that, but maybe it supports it. So, I mean, first of all, this run amok idea, maybe it's a difference in fundamental perspective, but I don't see courts running amok in environmental law. And if we're going to talk about running amok, probably the running amok is by agencies, which taking a fundamentally conservative, and I mean that in historical, not political sense, view, have no place in the system. The Constitution nowhere envisions the EPA to be making the breadth and scope of decision making about both public and private rights that it currently makes. And to say that that's because Congress is not doing its job, I think, is an objectively accurate statement. But as you point out, it begs the question of what the solution is. And that's why what I'm suggesting as a potential solution is not that courts should be making these decisions, but even looking at the doctrine of mandamus, that doesn't usually put courts in a decision-making. It simply recognizes that courts might need to hold government accountable to make a decision or to take an action. And one thing I was not very bold, I don't think, about is substantively what those decisions then would have to be. Courts could, for example, and I don't want to harp too much on Marywood's atmosphere of trust because I think I actually showed a lot of Jim's misgivings about it. But I don't think that would mean that courts are now in the business of solving climate change. I think it might simply mean that courts are telling the legislatures or that you need to take some action and make a decision on this.
Jim, did you have a comment?
Yeah, probably for Noah and Jim. Well, I think for all three of you, but Jim, I guess what I'm hearing you say that is, and I hope I have this right, that if in fact the cause of action is classically or what we would call traditional public trust law, that that doesn't run afoul of separation of powers, and it becomes a question of fact as to the source, causation, injury, what Noah addressed on standing redress, basically the ability of the court to actually and the parties litigate factual disputes that are tied to traditional public trust scope and standards. And I think I'm hearing you say that you don't have a problem with that, and then the question I would pose is, if that's the case, and someone could make a case for addressing a systemic threat, let's say like elbow bones, and let's just assume Lake Erie had one farmer, you know, who was doing all that, or one corporate farm, I don't think that poses a problem factually, either in traditional common law or in terms of courts handling the ability of a factual causation and injury that specifically violated rights of fishing and navigation to a serious degree that it actually subordinates the entire value of the western end of Lake Erie. So what would you
think about that? We had a side conversation earlier this morning, and I agree, if your path is to keep your feet in the water, so to speak, I think that's the right path, and I applaud that as a good lawyering strategy to try to draw the public trust doctrine to the kinds of issues you want to raise, as opposed to saying we can jump up onto the uplands and make similar claims. I think that's a far less defensible lawyerly argument. So I'm with you to that extent. I do think, however, that the courts do decide questions of fact, but only in reference to questions of law that are legitimately before them. So questions of fact about what the nature of climate change is are not for courts to decide unless that somehow relates to whether or not an existing property right or right in some other form is being violated. And I think that's what constrains the courts, is the rights that are at stake here, if we're going to be honest lawyers, are pretty narrow. They're important, but they're pretty narrow. And they don't include my right to breathe air that doesn't have too much carbon in it, or a whole lot of things short of that, but outside the traditional scope of the public trust. I mean, I look at, for example, in Oregon, this happened in a very different way, way back in the late 1960s, under the nomenclature of the ancient use doctrine, which only the Oregon Supreme Court had ever heard of, except way back in Old English law. But basically what happened, they said that the entire 300 and some miles of the Oregon beach, in which people had demonstrably vested title, you know, a good property lawyer would have said, yeah, they got title. With only one of those property owners in court, the Oregon Supreme Court said, none of you guys have title. Now that was, I think, from a policy point of view, the right answer, but achieved by a way that's very offensive to due process, for one thing, because all those other property owners were not there. And so the right answer to that, although maybe not a practical one, was to just buy those back, because they'd been granted by the state, clearly, for a century before that. And, you know, I mean, maybe it's like slavery, you know. Lincoln wanted to compensate the slaves, but it wasn't the slave owner, but it wasn't practical. And that strategy was abandoned, and maybe that's true in the case of the Oregon coast. I don't think it's quite a serious issue. But I think there are legal ways to go about this, and the takings clause, if it's honestly interpreted, which it hasn't been by most courts, is a constraint that has to be dealt with. The public can get it what it wants, and what it thinks it needs, it just has to pay for it.
Oh, sorry, I didn't see two hands. Lyman, you want to go ahead?
Okay, well, I was curious about looking at the scope of the public trust doctrine here and whether you limit it to the traditional common law. You mentioned maybe, as you might be willing to include that as part of the traditional public trust doctrine. So I'm wondering, in the Indiana context here, that's expanded perhaps slightly to allow beach sports and sunbathing and what people might want to do on the shoreline. So is, in your view, is that an appropriate reading of the public trust doctrine? If I want to walk along below the ordinary high water mark, all along the Indiana shoreline, Michigan shoreline, is that an appropriate right that the court should be able to protect under the public trust doctrine? Or has the court gone too far?
I think if we keep it within the geographical boundaries
whatever those are, and very safe to say whether it's a high water mark, low water mark, whatever. I think that that's a tough, you can make a plausible lawyerly argument for that, using what I think is the demand side of the view of the role of the common law judge, where the judge looks at what's the purpose of the existing rule. Well, it's really to provide the public uses that economic terms are really public goods, not going to be provided. And I think you might make that argument about many kinds of recreation and certainly access to the navigable waters. So I think that's within the realm of possibility. But as soon as you get outside of the geographic scope, I think it becomes much less plausible and a lot more of supply side lawmaking by judges who just think they're smarter than the rest of us.
And I actually need to take over the dark day comment on this one, Jim, because I saw the West versus Beverly Hills beach walking as both the logical outgrowth of the three core functions and very respectful of the overlapping public and private rights that are overlapping on that shoreline. And beach walking, I thought, was a fair balance between those public and private rights. Not, I love beaches. Full beach bum. And if you let me, I will, you know, I'll set up my blanket and I'll go to you and I will just enjoy the day and maybe the night and the next day as well. And that starts to really make one of what are the private rights then and what the upland property owners purchase with upland property adjacent to Lake Michigan or Lake Huron if I'm able to do that. And then furthermore, there's you know, the West versus Beckham case is actually not exactly clear what the environmental position was, as you might recall. Very good watershed organization in the state was rather siding with the private property owners out of concerns with things like recreational vehicles using the beach and the environmental harm that might occur. And so I think that I think it's a reason to generally support a lot of Jim's stated and published concerns about expansion of public trust action and putting these decisions in courts. Is, you know, as you expand the purposes and the scope of the public trust doctrine, the conflict between public and private rights is going to exacerbate, and the need for courts to take a more hands-on approach to environmental protection is going to exacerbate. So I'd be really cautious about which public uses you can allow.
No, I have a sort of follow-up. As I read Glass, the decision was that to the high water mark was subject to the public trust, but that it was to be managed by the DNRN agency as, for example, state parks are managed. And with the, at least intuitive, sense that a bunch of high school kids can't come up and do a bonfire and leave a lot of beer cans on the beach in front of your private property. Do you see it that way, or what are your concerns about that aspect of the case?
Maybe that's a fair intuitive sense, but from the, I was actually up on Glass versus Gecko property earlier this summer, and it's been 8 years or something since that case, and I was chatting with the property owners up there. It's the closest thing we have to holding ourselves accountable to revisiting the success of our litigation some years later, see how all of our social engineering has played out. I think that's a fair reading. But from the property owners' perspectives, they still have a lot of unanswered questions about, especially as property owners are closer and closer to public access points, what constitutes an abuse of the public right to use the shoreline, and how responsive is the DNR when you call them up and say, there's kids having a bonfire, which is perfectly allowed under Indiana law. You know, is that going to be a priority for the Department of Natural Resources to respond to? And one of the things I've noticed after the Glass versus Gecko case, even now, is it 8-9 years later, we still have a huge amount of uncertainty on that shoreline. And a lot of parties engaging in self-help. I see a lot of fences still. I see a lot of no trespassing signs that are clearly below the ordinary high water mark. I see a lot of public uses above the ordinary high water mark. And a lot of these questions really have not been very well resolved.
So I'm just going to ask a question.
As soon as we finish this discussion, we will adjourn
and move down to lunch. But I want you to
continue. Yeah, I just want to ask you a question about Indiana law. It sounded like Indiana courts are going to be rule of title of ownership. Is that accurate? I think that's an incorrect understanding of the hookup. You can, Noah can own all the way to the center of Lake Michigan, and I can still have a public trust right. It goes over that. Those are not incompatible. But it sounded like you were describing Indiana law as being a different type of title.
The court said a little bit of both. So the court said basically that Indiana received the bed of Lake Michigan up to the ordinary high water mark and has never given it away. But it might be possible somehow that private property extends below the ordinary high water mark. How that would be not
could the state give it away under the Indiana law and chose to for public rights?
Well, I don't think so. I think that would be conveying or pretending public rights in the bed of Lake Michigan. But it also seems to me that in adopting the administrative ordinary high water mark, they might have just
Catherine, did you want to jump in or do you want to save it for the afternoon? It's up to you.
I'm a little bit more of a problem. One of the things that I just introduced is not really here. So I guess I have comments that they may want to comment on. First, on Noah, we had three suggestions for things that we might be able to legitimately use the private trust doctrine for, the due process and judicial review standing. And I thought, add another one. I've got a fourth one and just in case I forget to say it later. A principle of statutory interpretation. You can get presumptions of statutory interpretation in line with the upholding of fundamental rights. And that's one of the things that's probably the easiest one for us to bring in the December, that I was going to add to the list. This debate on common law. There's a big difference between what the common law used to do, that old British idea of common law from which this arose, and what we call the common law now. I mean, that's what I wanted to bring up to you. It is true that the common law originally did, as you said, did respond to different circumstances. They came up with fundamental principles of human rights before they were put into the US Constitution. Right? That was the judgment law. And that was in a system where Parliament, well, first it wasn't a proper Parliament, they still had all these judges, that's where common law arose from. But even when Parliament came along, it was, Parliament became sovereign, they still had this judgment and common law. Right? And the principle was, you just, the circumstances as they arise, you just deal with it. And just because it hadn't been dealt with before, didn't mean you couldn't deal with it now. Right? So there was no limit, but just because it wasn't dealt with before, you didn't say, oh, it's a shadow. It doesn't have to be a shadow, which is what you're almost treating the common law as though it's just precedent, right? And where it didn't used to be. And so if you can make that historical distinction, you can actually treat it differently. I'm going to go on a little bit further about that difference, but you can't just say, oh, common, because it didn't do it before, means, oh, right, we're a little bit down this way right now. You can't change. It doesn't mean you might want it. Doesn't mean you can go as far as atmosphere. It's a general principle. That might, well, that doctrine you may develop a little bit back from law. There's maybe other rules that you can invoke to get that far, not just this one, but I just wanted to add that.
Thank you all so much.
Thanks very much, Professor Hand. It is a delight to be here. Thanks for the invitation. We did have a great lineup this morning and an equally great lineup this afternoon of speakers today. It's really sort of a smorgasbord, really, I'll call it maybe a buffet of speakers talking about very important topics, diverse topics, all with a foot at least on the public trust doctrine. So I think you'll find it very interesting today. Their biographies, very impressive, each one of them. They're in your program, so I won't belabor it at any great length, but I do want to give a couple of sentences about them, because what else am I going to do? All right, Nick Schreck, an associate clinical professor at Wayne State University Law School, where he directs and teaches at its Transnational Environmental Law Clinic and serves as executive director of its Great Lakes Environmental Law Center. Previously, he was an attorney with the National Wildlife Federation in Ann Arbor. Melissa Scanlon, welcome back to the Great Lakes region, is now in her third year at Vermont Law School, where she's Associate Dean of the Environmental Law Program and Director of the Environmental Law Center. Before that, she was affiliated with the University of Wisconsin Law School and the University of Wisconsin Milwaukee's School of Freshwater Sciences. And then Jim Olson is the founder and president of FLO, For Love of Water, an environmental advocacy organization headquartered in Traverse City. He has about, despite his youthful appearance, 40 years of experience practicing environmental and water law. And so with that, I think we're all lucky to have them here. And I'll turn it over to Professor Schreck.
Thank you, Ken, and I'm very honored to be here today, and thanks Professor Hand for inviting me and for really doing a lot to support our work in the clinic, and I love being able to bounce ideas off of you, and I think we've both taught each other's classes a couple times, and I really appreciate the fact that we're just up the road. It's nice that we're able to get together on occasions like this as well as just in our regular work. And thanks, Justin, I don't know if he's, there he is, for pulling this together. Really appreciate all the hard work that went into the symposium. I guess a couple of quick commercials. Ken didn't mention, but you have they have a conference, an annual conference on the Great Lakes at University of Toledo Law School that is always wonderful. So if you're interested in these topics, it's November 6th, usually the first Friday in November every year. So go down there to Toledo. It's a great conference. They always have a wonderful lineup of speakers, and I've been fortunate to be there a couple times. One more commercial, mainly for the students in the room. If you're interested at all in environmental law, make sure when you're in law school and when you're out of law school that you join our state bar environmental section, okay? As a first year attorney out of law school, I believe you can join for free. So why wouldn't you, right? If you have any remote interest in the topic, join the section. That way you can keep up to date on all the different things that leading environmental attorneys are working on in the state. Just a couple days ago, Jim Olson presented on a webinar that we had on oil pipelines and Line 5, the pipeline through the Straits of Mackinac. And those are the types of academic webinars that we often put on through the environmental section. Okay, enough of the commercials. I'm probably burning through my time here, so I better get going. Microplastics. So a quick outline, we'll talk about, and I'll use the terms microbeads and microplastics more or less interchangeably, but there are some differences that I'll highlight. Talk a little bit about state responses to this problem, federal responses, if any. And then at the end, I'll talk a little bit about some common law solutions and an idea, perhaps a bit of a stretch, to look at using public trust principles in dealing with microbead pollution. Okay, has anyone heard of the Great Pacific Garbage Patch at all, right? Or the large gyres of floating plastic in the middle of our oceans? So this is a problem we've known about for years in the oceans. And over time, people started to think, well, gosh, I wonder about the Great Lakes. We haven't identified these large islands of plastic in the Great Lakes, thankfully, but there's an assumption that there was likely plastic particles in the Great Lakes, and it was something that needed to be researched. And so I'll talk a little bit more about some of the results of that research in a moment. What are microbeads? Well, these are tiny plastic particles, little plastic beads that are used for exfoliants in a myriad of personal care products. So soaps, sanitizers, toothpaste, as was mentioned this morning, all sorts of personal care products have microbeads added. Now, some of you, this might shock you, but I don't typically use a lot of exfoliants myself, but some of you may have used over time scrubs with like sugar scrubs, or there's natural products like walnut shells and things, almond shells that are used as exfoliants. So we'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute, but we're really talking about those exfoliants. So what it uses when you're washing your face or brushing your teeth to help the product do what it's designed to do. Now, microbeads are plastic. So they're made out of polyethylene and polypropylene. And why is that a problem? Well, Great Lakes, obviously, we've heard a lot about the Great Lakes, largest surface freshwater system on Earth. And this thought was, well, gosh, if there's all this plastic floating around in the ocean, there's probably a lot of plastics floating around in the Great Lakes. So there was a collaborative study effort a few years ago between the Five Gyres Institute and SUNY Fredonia where they looked at, they actually went around and sampled Great Lakes water, looking for plastics, looking for microbeads, but all sorts of plastics in the Great Lakes. And they found some pretty staggering concentrations. And when you look at the amount of plastic that they found, microbeads, these tiny plastic particles, were about 90% of the total plastics that they found when they took sampling in the Great Lakes. The average there are 43,000 particles per square kilometer. You know, it's a little bit smaller than a mile, right? So that amount of plastic was found on average around the Great Lakes, especially high concentrations in Lake Erie. Now, Lake Erie is shallowest of the Great Lakes, and so I think that might be part of the reason. It's also getting towards the end of the system, so things that are kind of going through the Great Lakes system are more likely collecting in Lake Erie than in the upper Great Lakes. Well, how do these microplastics get into our surface waters? Interestingly, and in fact, the manufacturers of these products have said that they didn't realize that these plastic beads would not be screened out at wastewater treatment plants. But the fact is that the size of these particles are so small that they do pass through wastewater treatment plants to some degree and make their way into our surface waters. There's also, I'm sure, they get in through other types of non-point runoff, surface runoff, they get into our water, but by and large, they're coming all the way through, you know, washed off our faces, into the drain, through the sewer, the wastewater treatment plant, on through all the different treatment processes, and then out into the water. And they're not screened out, and in fact, they hadn't been testing for the, or even really looking for these particles until relatively recently. All right, so in the article that we're working on, we found a couple of studies looking at potential damage, and you know, these estimates are hard to come up with, but somebody says, oh, you know, $13 billion estimated economic damages from microbead pollution worldwide. And because of the small size of these plastics, removing them once they are into the aquatic environment, it's very, very difficult to get them out. Unlike, say, if you have floating plastic in the middle of the ocean, presumably there's ways to go out there and get it if we had the will and the resources to do that. A much harder problem with these small plastic particles. It's unknown how long they will remain in our surface waters, how long it takes to break down. There's some guesses at that, but depending on the temperature of the lakes, the amount of sunlight that they're exposed to, that has a bearing on how quickly the plastics break down or don't break down. So fish and birds can mistake plastics for food. I saved you all right after lunch, and I did not put up pictures of gulls with their stomachs full of plastic dead on beaches. If you feel the need to look at that, Google it. It's really disturbing. Happening a lot in the ocean environment in particular, where seabirds are dying and feeding their babies pieces of plastic that they mistake for food. So that's a danger. Also, you know, there's a lot of additives when we look at plastics, these plasticizers, so flame retardants, and we found that these microbeads actually absorb other chemicals, other contaminants that are out there in the aquatic environment. They more or less act like a sponge for other chemicals and for even some things like viruses, right? That they actually are attracted to and they cling to these microbeads, so they become almost like a toxic pill that smaller organisms and then intake and then those accumulate on the food chain. So the concern is that over time this can create a hazard to humans and wildlife. So, you know, polyethylene doesn't decompose, but you know, plastics do break down. They do get smaller. So some of the, when we talk about microplastics and microbeads, the beads are things really talking about personal care products. Microplastics are the small bits of big plastic that's broken down over time. And this process can take many years, as I said, depending on the amount of sunlight that they're exposed to, temperature, that type of thing. And as of now, we really do not know the overall effect that this will have on our ecosystem. And we really don't know what, if any, threats this poses to our drinking water, okay? These plasticizers and other compounds within plastics, as they break down over time in our surface water, 40 million people in the Great Lakes region, in the United States and Canada, get our drinking water directly from the Great Lakes. So it's not an insignificant amount of people that are potentially affected by plastics and plastic compounds in our drinking water supply. All right, so what do we do about it? So far, most of the energy has been around banning. Banning these personal care products, banning microbeads from being present in personal care products. So we have a list here of the states that we just updated. California that just recently passed a ban. And what's interesting about this list, so far, you know, here in the Great Lakes region, we have Illinois and Indiana and Wisconsin, so we're not quite halfway there with getting all the states on board. Michigan has proposed similar legislation, which we'll talk about in just a minute. And these bans are, perhaps surprisingly, they haven't been fought with a great degree of intensity by the companies, by the manufacturers. In fact, when Illinois was considering their ban, they talked to some of the manufacturers and they said, yeah, it's something we can go along with. There's other alternatives. I mentioned, you know, walnut shells that you could potentially use as exfoliants, sugar scrubs, that type of thing. So there are alternatives that manufacturers are willing to look at. So I'll talk about Michigan's proposed legislation in a minute, and then I will very briefly touch on some of our potential state laws that we could use to try and get at this problem. So there is proposed legislation in Michigan that would ban microbeads, and the fear is that, as has been happening a lot lately in the state of Michigan, we feel the need to improve on legislation that other states have passed. And so with our proposed ban on microbeads, there's this question of whether or not it is biodegradable. And so they added this language saying that we had to, you know, use a non-biodegradable solid plastic particle, that would be banned. Well, you know, a lot of things that are, they might biodegrade over 1,000 years, okay? And so there's a question of the language, you know, why not just say we're banning all plastics, all plastic microbeads from our products? And if you want a deeper dive on this particular legislation, Monday morning, I'm doing a radio interview on WDET 101.9 with the representative that introduced this bill. We'll be talking about it in great detail. I don't have time to get into it today, but I will just say that the question is over this definition of biodegradable. What do we mean by that? Rather than just a blanket outright ban. Interestingly, California, they're even banning like all exfoliants. So that is going to be really interesting to see, even things like organic type products as exfoliants. So there's a lot of flux right now with these statewide bans. Okay, so also in Michigan, we have our Natural Resource Environmental Protection Act. So the idea here would be trying to get at changing our water quality standards, how we control pollution to our surface waters through state law. This is, you know, you could have a petition for rulemaking to DEQ to perhaps change our water quality standards to deal specifically with microbeads. Michigan Environmental Protection Act. Jim has rightfully gotten a lot of kudos for his public trust work. He's also been such a champion for so many years on the Michigan Environmental Protection Act. And he's got a great little article, it's a quick read you should check out, called The MEPA Lives. And it really talks about the development of that law. And I will just say that the standard in the Michigan Environmental Protection Act of conduct that is likely to pollute, impair, destroy our natural resources, including the Great Lakes, of course, that's the question under MEPA. And I think, you know, allowing these products to continue to be used where we have no way of screening this plastic waste from getting into the environment, that's a potential MEPA claim there. And I always put the note there in the bottom. I always talk to my students, you know, what's the most important thing as an attorney? You know, you have to get paid. So we have an issue with attorney's fees under MEPA, unfavorable state Supreme Court, or state Court of Appeals precedent regarding attorney's fees. So that's why we don't see, I think, a big flood of MEPA litigation in the state of Michigan. Okay, federal responses. What is the federal government doing? We have these state bans that have been proposed and enacted. Well, not a whole heck of a lot. So the question would be, can we get at this microbead problem through some of our various federal environmental laws? So we've actually looked at a potential, you know, going to EPA and saying, like, what about requiring environmental impact statements or environmental assessments for these personal care products before they're allowed onto the market? And, you know, we can get a hook here by looking at EPA's approval of NPDES or NPDES permits as major federal actions. Also, the federal government provides a lot of money to the state revolving loan fund for wastewater infrastructure, sewage infrastructure. So there is a potential hook in using National Environmental Policy Act to at least require some sort of environmental assessment on the front end of what these these microbeads could do once they reach the aquatic environment. Total maximum daily load under Clean Water Act. I don't know, crazy idea. What about looking at whether or not plastic is causing an impairment of our Great Lakes waters? Are the Great Lakes actually impaired by plastic? And if so, how about setting a total maximum daily load for plastics under the Clean Water Act? There's a few steps that it would take to get to this point, but I mean, I think using the existing tools that we have, this is one perhaps creative solution that we've looked at to potentially, again, get at this problem of reducing the amount of plastics that we allow into the Great Lakes. Administrative solutions, we heard a lot about administrative law this morning and then agencies and their action, but you know, looking at a petition to EPA or FDA to try and get at this problem of microbeads, there's a, you know, citizens, anyone can petition these agencies for a rulemaking, and you know, FDA does have regulatory approval or authority over personal care products under the Food, Drug, and Cosmetics Act, but they're not that closely regulated as we've seen. They're already allowing these things out into the environment. Great Lakes Environmental Law Center, we've petitioned FDA in the past on the issue of pharmaceuticals that get into our water. So humans taking drugs pass through our body, go down the toilet to the wastewater treatment plant, causing all kinds of problems out there in the aquatic environment. We didn't ultimately get a blanket environmental assessment required for all human drugs and biologics, but we did get a very good response from FDA that they were actually looking at endocrine disrupting chemicals and these really kind of dangerous chemicals that are out there in the environment. So that is another potential idea, is a petition to our federal agencies for rulemaking. There we go. Okay, so thankfully we had a great discussion of public trust this morning, so I won't have to get into a lot of the details there, but as we heard about here in Michigan, we recognize fishing, discussion over hunting, boating, and so what I'm going to focus on is, as well as some other public trust uses that we've heard, but I'm going to focus on fishing. So, and again, we've really heard a lot about this already. I don't think I need to get into Illinois Central. But yeah, so this question of, you know, can we use the public trust doctrine for pollution control? It, as we've heard, it's a bit of a stretch, but you know, we do have a case in Michigan dealing with the Detroit River and how this area is frequently used for boating and fishing, and that was recognized as a public trust interest. And so the idea would be that if we are poisoning our fish to the extent that we are harming the fish, and we're, that is then impacting our public trust right, that I think would be the argument we try to develop under the public trust. As I said, these tiny plastic particles are not only harmful and dangerous in their own right, but they also attract various other chemicals and viruses that can potentially be very harmful to fish populations. And as people around the Great Lakes region that eat Great Lakes fish, there's a question of, do these things, how long do they stay in our bodies, and what effect might they have, and is there this potential for bioaccumulation? So that, I think, would be the argument that we'd make under the public trust. Just a couple other quick common law solutions. You know, perhaps going under a nuisance theory, whether it be a public or private nuisance, and that these microbeads are basically interfering with our public-private rights. And with that, I think I will stop, and I'm really looking forward to the other panelists, and then I look forward to your questions after that. So thank you very much.
It's a real pleasure to be in a group of people who care about the public trust doctrine. It's a rare day where you get to spend the entire day thinking about something as narrow and yet as broad in terms of impacting so much that we sometimes don't even think about as the public trust doctrine. So I appreciate that, and thank you to the organizers for all the details. I fortunately get to skip through a lot of this because so much of the groundwork was laid, and I can just jump to the parts that I think need more attention. So I'll start us off thinking about water as a commons, and spend a little more time talking about the equal footing doctrine, how the trust property originally got transferred to the states. And then I'll get into my proposal for how to focus our attention more on the Great Lakes and enjoy the Great Lakes more, and hopefully build more of a political constituency ultimately for the protections of the lakes. So water as a commons. We live in this place that's just so incredibly rich with water, and it's a shared water commons. We heard about this morning how the public trust doctrine is the foundation of water law. And really that has to be because of the functional nature of water. It is something that we share. It's recycling, we use it, we take it out, it's used to manufacture our clothes, it's used to manufacture our food, to grow our food, it's used to power our cities. And it's used and then put back into the system. It's a recycling system. So that's the quintessential type of commons. And that's why we have the public trust doctrine as a legal doctrine that has developed to govern how we relate to this commons, because it is such a special type of property, unlike your cell phone or your car or something that can be more readily individually owned. Hello. Thought we were working here. Okay. You can. Really? That would be lovely. I'll click at you and you click through. Let's see how this works. Did my human click it work?
There we go.
There we go. Okay. We can keep clicking. So that was the King of England spoof for you. So in English common law, the tidal waters were held by the crown up to the ordinary high water mark. You did hear that this morning. And there was a concept of overlapping rights, the hus publicum and the hus privatum. So although there could be private title granted in the tidal waters, the king would not extinguish public rights even in those areas where private title was granted. Hopefully thinking about that concept of overlapping rights helps clear up some of the discussion that was happening this morning with sort of disputed histories about the public trust doctrine. I think it's a helpful concept. When we became the United States, when the colonies broke from England, we incorporated that concept into the laws of the early colonies, into the laws of the early states. And when the new states entered the Union on equal footing with the original ones, they also received these waters that were governed in trust. For the United States, it was all navigable waters. You also heard about that this morning, how we broke beyond the tidal waters to all navigable waters. They passed to the states up to that property was up to the ordinary high water mark. So there was a distinct line. This case from 1894 did tell us that. What gets confusing then is whether or not states try to ultimately vary from that ordinary high water mark. But here we have the Great Lakes, and we have the benefit of the Northwest Territory of 1787, which also gives us this similar kind of idea that the waters in this area, the navigable waters and the carrying places between them, are going to be forever free. So we have this additional foundation in making sure that these areas are held in trust. So I'm not going to get into the public trust too deeply, but I do want to bring this analogy to you, that it's like a financial trust, where you have beneficiaries and an identified trustee, and you have property. The trust property is the navigable water up to the ordinary high water mark. One more, there. And here's a picture that shows, if I had a highlighter on here, it shows where the ordinary high water mark is. It's above the average water level. And it's, we heard this morning that it's sometimes set by an elevation, and in some states like Michigan, it's set by administratively by looking at where the vegetation starts at piling up on the shore. So that's it for public trust, actually, in terms of the scope of it. So the public rights under the public trust doctrine reflect our uses, and they evolve over time. And yet, historically, they did include not only fishing, navigation, and commerce, which you heard this morning, but the right of passage. That was a right recognized in English common law, and it was a right recognized in many of the early states. It's important to this topic for today to talk about my concept. Modern public rights vary by state, but are more expansive and include things like recreation and purity, natural beauty, and access. So these are all public rights. Fishing is a public right. Boating, wildlife and aesthetics, beach walking, is it a public right? Is it a public right? Is it protected? Even though I told you it was historically, it was. Why do we see these private property signs all over the beaches? If beach walking is a public right, that's probably a common sign for you guys have seen this. Even in Michigan, you see these private property signs. And Michigan was the first state in the Great Lakes to take up this issue in the Glass versus Gecko case, this first Supreme Court decision. To take up the issue of whether or not walking along the shore of the Great Lakes in that area up to the ordinary high water mark is a protected public right. And the question here was, did Joan Glass trespass when she was walking in that area? The Gecko's deed went to the meander line of Lake Huron. That's below, that's lakeward of the ordinary high water mark. So it was an excellent fact pattern to settle this issue. And the court did decide that there is an inalienable public trust easement in this zone up to the ordinary high water mark, regardless of what the deed says or how whether or not the deed has granted title below that line. It's beyond the power of the state to extinguish this public trust easement. And that was based on this historic rite of passage of walking was seen as something that we have done from time immemorial. And it was also grounded in the Northwest Ordinance and the forever free language that I mentioned earlier, common highways language. So that brings me to hiking on national scenic trails with my children. And at the same time, writing about the public trust doctrine and this space on the beach and what our rights are, when I came to this idea that we have a trail, a bi-national trail along all of the Great Lakes shorelines within the public trust easement, but it's not been demarcated, it's not been identified, but it exists, and we just need to be able to visualize it. So those are the Great Lakes, and we have 10,900 miles of Great Lakes shoreline. So some of that, of course, is not accessible for people because it's bluffs. Some of it's been, a lot of it's been developed, and so inaccessible because of power plants and things like that. So there are obstacles, but that's an enormous coastline to be able to work with in order to build a trail. And in Michigan alone, you have 2,200 miles of coastline. That is slightly longer than the Appalachian Trail from Georgia to Maine, the iconic national scenic trail for this country. And if Michigan acted first, you would have more trail miles than the Appalachian Trail, which is really astounding. So, my proposal is to create the Great Lakes Coastal Trail. And what we would do with this is, my human clicker is really late. I have a lot of clicks. So we would demarcate this trail, and the part of the point is to increase public access and use of the coastal shorelines for walking, and in a way that's consistent with neighboring uses. I think this would reduce trespassing because it would quiet the boundary. It would settle where the boundary is, where the end of the public rights boundary is, and it would narrow what could be done on that within that boundary. So you heard from Professor Hall this morning talking about how he would put his blanket out and stay there for days on the beach, you know. But if this were a national scenic trail, that wouldn't really be okay. It would be a rite of passage only. So some people will oppose this idea because they'll see this as a narrowing of public rights. I think on balance, it's a balancing of public rights and private interests, and it will ultimately open up a lot more space to recreation. So it's okay to give up allowing Noah to camp overnight on the beach in order to get maybe 2,200 miles of walking in the state of Michigan, or 10,000 around the entire Great Lakes. The other thing I think this would do is that it would engage and educate people about the importance of the Great Lakes in a way that we aren't really doing effectively with our policy talks. It will bring people out to actually see what the public trust is all about, what that protection is, and make it real for people beyond some kind of concept that really is feels ancient and disconnected from people's lives. And it will restore, I think, a sense of awe that we're missing in our lives. And we need a sense of awe in order to take action to protect the things that we love. So the Ice Age Trail, so the National Scenic Trail over in your neighboring state of Wisconsin, has 1,300 volunteers. They had 1,300 volunteers in 2013. I put that figure up there because I thought that was sort of astounding given it's a small, not a very large trail, and that's a lot of activity going on around something as narrow as a trail. So imagine what we could get around the Great Lakes. I think it also will raise awareness about threats to ecology and the pollution that is happening within the Great Lakes. Because if you're walking along the trail and you've got to bypass a nuclear power plant, that's going to mean something to you in a different way than if you never saw it. If you're walking along the trail and you're seeing some kind of invasive species that is clogging the area that someone has had to hack a path through, that's going to make the issue become a lot more real to people. I also think that this will promote tourism in the Great Lakes in a way that we really need to be doing. The area is underappreciated. It's called a flyover zone. You know, those of us who know it and love it understand what's special about this area. But a lot of people miss out on the gem that is the Great Lakes. And we could be bringing in millions of people to hike within the Great Lakes and to understand why it's important and to be spending their tourism dollars here. The Appalachian Trail, by comparison, has 3 to 4 million hikers every year. That trail goes through my town, so I see those hikers every day going through there. It's just a steady stream of people going into our small town store, and it's really good for the region. Some similar coastal trails that we could learn from are the Scottish Coastal Trail and the Cotswold Walks that do have all sorts of services, bed and breakfasts, concierge services, carrying people's bags from point to point. We could similarly have those kind of small businesses sprouting up in the Great Lakes. We could have people who are transporting bikes and kayaks and helping people. We do multimodal kind of expedition around the Great Lakes. And with GIS capabilities and smartphones, all of that, I think small businesses will become much more available to people who would access such a trail. This is from a book written by Lorene Neuhaus, who's a Michigan author, and I put it up here just to show that it is actually possible. There is someone who has walked around the entire coastline of Lake Michigan. She wrote a book about it. Then she walked around another 1,000-mile trek around segments of all of the Great Lakes, wrote another book about that. So this is not some esoteric idea. And also, this was not a super athlete. No offense to Lorene. She was just an ordinary person who went on some really long walks. So it makes it very, I think, accessible to people. So here's the thumbnail of what would need to happen in order to implement this. We would need a lot of community engagement. We would need political leaders who would come out of that community engagement. We would need GIS mapping and a master plan. We need to involve the business sector in this because of all of the business potential. And we need to involve scientists to make sure that we were protecting ecologically sensitive areas and avoiding places that people really shouldn't be entering. And there's actually a known process in the law for how to get a national scenic trail established. It's the National Trail System Act of 1968, and it's a two-step process. So first you need a congressional approval of a feasibility study. That's usually conducted by the National Park Service. And then based on that study, Congress needs to act again to approve the trail. It's a two-step process. Michigan has two representatives on the committee that would take up this authorization of, could take up authorization of feasibility study. I believe they're the only Great Lakes members who are on that committee. So Michigan is actually poised, if it wanted to take action, is poised to take some leadership on this. Another concept I want to touch on here is that this isn't starting from scratch. We really need to be connecting to the existing trails. There are a number of trails that are already developed around the Great Lakes, and especially on the Canadian side, but I'll start with on the US side in Michigan. You've got Sleeping Bear Dunes and all the trails connected to that, and then there are land trusts, held lands adjacent to the dunes. So there are quite a few miles already established in Michigan. Then we have the Lake Michigan Water Trail, which has a goal of 1,600 miles of trail, and that's mapping Michigan's segment of it. That's already an effort that's underway. The water trail is for non-motorized boats, and we'll be identifying the landing places and camping places all along Lake Michigan for that mode of transportation. And then I mentioned Canada. Canada's much further ahead than we are in terms of having a trail system that's attached to the Great Lakes. It's not on the coastline, it's up from it because it's a multi-use bike and walk trail. But they already have over 870 miles built, and they're working their way westward with this great waterfront trail. There's also a Voyager trail on the north side of Lake Superior that's working its way eastward, and they should connect within the next couple of years. So Canada's almost got this whole thing built off the coastline. So if the US could act, we really could have a binational trail system. We also have North Country Trail, 4,200 miles, that's running through the Great Lakes region and ultimately connecting over, now I think it's going to connect to Vermont in the long trail. So with that, I'm gonna close with this saying about making the road by walking. And my point with reminding you of this saying is that we don't need to wait until there is an act of Congress to recognize a national scenic trail. The public trust doctrine is available to us all today. The easement is open for use. We are all trust fund kids today. And we can go out and walk along the shorelines whenever we want. So please enjoy it.
Well, good afternoon. Raise your hand, stretch. I want to thank the law school, Dean Jackie, Justin, there he is, the Board of Editors of the Law Review, for having the vision and the determination to hold this symposium today. I have to confess, I was up to my ears in something else last spring. The notice went out for this, and I didn't notice that this was going on until the middle of the summer. And as president of FLO and the goals that we have at FLO regarding educating the public about the public trust doctrine, the Commons of the Great Lakes, and exploring practical solutions to the systemic threats that we face, I thought, wow, the Law Review gets it. And so it was really exciting, and I'm the kid in the back room going, hey, can I go with you? And so I called Jack, or I got a hold of Jackie and Justin, and they graciously put me on the program because I raised my hand in the back of the room. So I am very grateful to all of you for being here. I also want to thank the morning speakers. I think the contrast of the presentations and the ideas are very valuable for this discussion. It's never a good idea to have one side of anything because people think in different ranges and for different reasons. And we learn over time by testing those ideas out as to which float and which sink and don't belong there. And I think my own view of the law is somewhat like Justice Holmes' famous quote, that the life of the law is not logic but experience. And I think if there's any doctrine that, albeit ancient, demonstrates that, by the very fact that it's still here after almost 2,000 years, like the public trust doctrine, is testimony in itself about its viability, its dynamic nature, and the premise of experience of human beings who are the beneficiaries of the commons, as the speakers have identified and described, and which Melissa just talked about. So I can't think of a better subject as we move into this century here in the Great Lakes Basin than this. Well, I'm going to do a couple of things. One is I'm going to try to fill in some gaps, like Melissa. Some of us, I think Noah and Jim and Alexis did such a fine job, we don't have to go through some of this, but I just want to also point out a few things, and after that, I want to share with you a project at FLO, FLO for Love of Water, which is a nonprofit organization residenced in Traverse City that works on policy issues in the Great Lakes Basin, specifically public trust solutions to the systemic threats that we face in this century. Our goal at FLO is not to say this is the answer, follow us. It is to say these are the facts, this is the law, how might this apply? Our executive director, Liz Kirkwood, is right here. Liz, if you would just stand up real quick or raise your hand.
Hi.
Liz came to FLO about 4 years ago. Since she came, we have been on the fly. And working mostly on substantive matters, but also all the other things that goes running a nonprofit organization, which is, of course, a new experience for me, having been a trial lawyer most of my life in work. But FLO, I think you can think of us as a laboratory. We want to do what you envision here at this conference. We want to explore the reality of solutions to these systemic threats. So let me just go real quick, and I hope I go right and left. I hope this works. Ah, here we go. So I'm just going to go fast. Well, we already heard about this, the roots of the common law of public trust. I would just make a couple of observations here. One is, think of the common law coming down to the United States from England with these various roots and with a couple of propositions. One is, before there was private property, there was commons. It existed in the crown, and it existed in custom at the pleasure of the crown, of course, but human custom with respect to the rivers and shores of England. And even though, as Jim Huffman described, that the barons and the crown had a fight, the basic principles underlying that recognize that the crown can't interfere with fundamental common rights, nor can other private interests, as we know from private disputes like the one Noah described this morning, last we go in Michigan and many others. The other thing is that when private property was developed, it came to this country, the idea of deeds and conveyances and ownership, the exclusive possession, the bundle of sticks. One of the sticks was the right to use water. And as Noah Hall, Professor Hall said this morning, it's a usufruct. It is not an actual ownership of the water. So indeed, when this country took in Arnold v. Mundy and Martin versus Waddell and all the cases leading up to Illinois Central and public trust law, when we took, the state took title, became in the position of the crown. Only it was a little different because it's a sovereign control representing the public. So not only does the government have the sovereign responsibility, but it is also, when you have a public trust navigable water issue, or if a state follows a different expanded version of that, you actually have an obligation and trustee obligation and beneficiaries. But the point I'm making is the commons hasn't gone anywhere. And we this morning, I think we were a little bit about private rights versus common rights and where you draw this line. In fact, the commons is whole. And there are rights of private use in that commons suggested by Melissa, where the public rights and use exist paramount over the private. And you basically have to work that out. There's some balancing that goes on. It's similar to the correlative rights doctrine in water law in some respects. So I think it's important to understand that you think of this as commons that came to us, and then you have private property with rights to use the commons, not own the commons. And so we begin to think what Grant Trigger was saying about, and what I think he raised some wonderful questions in his lunch talk. But basically this whole question of commodification, privatization of something that is so fundamentally common, and whether or not there are limits on that alienation, and just what are those? And when can there be alienation, as suggested by Jim Huffman. It's a very narrow set of circumstances where you can ever have alienation of the public trust aspect of the commons. So commons in water, commons in natural resources, some of those commons are public trust. And public trust is just not the right to use. Again, as Noah Hall said, it's a limitation inherent, and I think Jim Huffman said this too, inherent in the background principles of property law. The background principles of property law. And the commons is right there, more in the background than particularly when it comes to water and public trust resources. So, we got enough of that. Okay, trustees, beneficiaries. We're 40 million beneficiaries here in the Great Lakes Basin. And we invite guests, of course, you can't exclude them. Okay, some of the protected uses. The courts vary. This is my list, and I agree the traditional original list was much narrower, navigation, fishing, and shipping, and commerce, and also the carrying free language in the Northwest Ordinance. I think that was great to take us back to that, to think about this. So navigation, I'm putting passage up on the slide next time. But navigation, common fishing, swimming, drinking water, or sustenance. Where does sustenance come from? It's in the Arnold V. Mundy decision. And by the way, Arnold V. Mundy, even though one aspect about the authority of the state to alienate under some narrow circumstances may have been overturned, the fundamental holding and background and adoption of commons and public trust in waters in Arnold v. Mundy and the recognition of this commons was not overturned. It is still the law of New Jersey. So that should be clear. The interesting thing about sustenance is that drinking water and sustenance is sustainability. Sustenance is ecosystem. So, you know, protecting that which sustains us, which I think is a good thing to think about when you look at the threats to the Great Lakes Basin and what we do about it in terms of common public trust law. We didn't have a discussion on the duty, and I just mentioned that the courts typically call this a perpetual duty, a continuing duty, a very solemn duty, and therefore it's close to what you learn in trust law to a fiduciary duty. It's not something we take lightly. Illinois Central. The important piece to me in Illinois Central, in addition to the things you've heard today, is this alienation. The state can no more abdicate its trust over property than what they're interested in, and it can abdicate its police power. So you have this sort of public trust property power, and then the police power of government. There's a fundamental prohibition against alienation. So even if you can convey a chunk of bottomlands within the exceptions of Illinois Central Railroad, the public aspect can never be handed over. Line 5 in the Straits of Mackinac, and Liz Kirkwood has done an op-ed on Line 5, which is out in the materials along with the flow brochure if you didn't get those. But essentially, the company is claiming, we have an easement, you can't touch us. You cannot touch the four corners of this easement. We can do whatever we want based on the contract that we got. And the reality is, that is not true under public trust law, because the state can't give up its control, and if we learn more because of science and facts over time, the state is not precluded from engaging in its responsibility to protect the public trust. And that's an important principle, because whoever holds title to public trust or title to property or an easement, like the company Enbridge under Line 5, it is in effect a misnomer, because it's an easement subject to the ability of the state. It's more like a license, the ability of the state to even revoke it should the public trust be violated, because the public trust can never be conveyed away. And Illinois Central says that. The company got a deed in the Supreme, and they said, you know, we're not giving it back to the Attorney General of Illinois back there in the 1800s. And you can actually, in the Newberry Museum, there's all kinds of newspaper articles of what went on then. And it was quite a few years of a battle. And essentially, the Supreme Court said the deed's worthless. So it is a fundamental limitation on government and private, and raises some very fundamental questions raised by other speakers about drawing the line between commons and private property, and private property against that background principle and backdrop. And I hope you understand that facts, as law students and lawyers and professors, all of us, we understand that facts change, that facts fit principle. And we have a continuing common law that makes those decisions, and the courts are not some second-rate branch of government. Separation of powers has three branches of government. When government fails, it is the responsibility of lawyers in the courts to protect the rights of citizens, business people, I don't care, corporations. It's a very important role in this country, and if we lose sight of that, and who was talking about administration going amok, but maybe you know what. But if we lose sight of that and buy into administrative law going amok, we are not exercising the inalienable right, and we're not protecting our clients as lawyers and leaders or our citizens. So let's move on. I'm going to just skip past. Well, here's just a list of principles that I like from case law. These are not necessarily majority rule, but in most instances, I think they are. It's just that a few of these have only been touched on by a couple of state courts. But the non-alienation, obviously, very important, right from the early common law, no interference or impairment. It's material impairment. It isn't impairment or interference. It has to be somewhat significant, at least measurable. Duty to account for protection. This is an affirmative duty, as you can see down in 3, a corollary principle. Some corollary, the burden of proof is on the person who seeks to alter the public trust. All right? The burden, the substantial value, there's a nice case in Michigan called Grossio Dredging Company case back in the 70s, I think it was. And the court said the public trust is presumed. If you're the one that wants to alter the public trust, in this case, dredge it, it's your responsibility to demonstrate that there is no substantial public value and that if there is, that you're not impairing it. And that's an important proposition because I think it gets somewhat at your de novo suggestion, Professor Hall, this morning, that it plays with the standing and de novo idea of actually getting at something that rights to wrong, because burden of proof is usually you preserve the status quo. The status quo is our relationship to water, protected by the public trust doctrine. Those who seek to alter the status quo ought to have the burden of proof. That's something that we need to talk about. If you're curious, I suggested that in an essay at Lewis and Clark Law School's Law Journal back in the late 80s as something to ponder. So, what are some of the extensions that we were talking about? I'd like to just clarify a couple of things here. California, in the Mile Lake case, basically said things that happen in non-tributary waters, even though they are not public trust per se, if they affect the public trust, swimming, boating, fishing, and ecosystem, such as Mile Lake downstream, violate the public trust doctrine. That was a major diversion case in Los Angeles, and it was limited because of the public trust doctrine. And the interesting thing is that it did not jump out of the bounds, really, of traditional public trust law, because the court stood in Mono Lake and said, what's happening here? Oh, fishing, swimming, wildlife are being destroyed. Oh, let's look up the watershed and find out what's going on and stop that, because it's violating the right of the public. The government and the crown or government or private individuals are not supposed to impair the beneficiary rights of citizens, and government has a duty to protect those. And that was reaffirmed in the case Light versus Water Board last year in California, extending public trust to both to connected streams and groundwater on the principles of national fauna. Hawaii, groundwater is a public trust in Hawaii. The cases typically involve a connection of groundwater and stream water. Again, as you would expect, this hydrologic connection and part of the water cycle. And the interesting thing is that was a combination of common law and constitution. And we didn't talk about this yet, but the constitution can be interpreted by the courts if the constitutions explicitly include public trust language, because states basically have the power, according to Supreme Court law, that they have the power to determine their property law, which includes defining the extent and nature of the public trust doctrine, which was reaffirmed, I think, in the U.S. Supreme Court Montana case a couple of years ago, Montana PPL case. So, Vermont did the same thing. They protected groundwater by public trust by statute. Okay, and the first court to look at it said, hey, you can't issue a permit involving waste discharge unless you consider the impact on the public trust in groundwater or connected surface water. Right? Wisconsin, this is a very significant case because it's very significant because the principle was one, the exact fighting question was lost. But this is a water plant wanting to use water from a nearby lake
It was approved. Those objecting said, hey, you didn't consider the public trust impact according to your duties under Wisconsin law, and by the way, the public trust doctrine, which sits behind those laws and imposes this duty upon you, that in fact, the Supreme Court of Wisconsin said, you have to consider the impact of the public trust as part of your function and permit review, or your review is void. So, did the court have to say groundwater was subject to public trust? No, the court said, looking at it from Lake Beulah up the watershed, what happens up there and what you're permitting over here in groundwater or on the land, you still have to look at the impact on public trust, because otherwise public trust, you could have all the best public trust protections in the world concerning water. If you draw the line at the water's edge and you don't look at what's happening in the watershed, that could actually be destroying the public trust more rapidly, more dramatically, than the things that happen directly. And after all, things that happen directly or indirectly, I don't know if it's all in the watershed and it's affecting the arc of the water table, I'm not even sure it's indirect. Whether you have the pipe sending water to the west or out of Lake Michigan, or you have the pipe in groundwater sending water to the west, does it really matter if it's dropping public trust waters or impairing navigable lakes and streams? I don't think so. So that's just a little bit of background. Now let's, just one idea, and then I'm going to jump to Flo's project just for 5 minutes. I think I have about five left that I see here. Is that all right with everybody? Okay. All right, so.
Five.
Huh? Five, thank you. And thank you, Ken. Our moderator, Ken. So I just want to look at this. So we're beginning to have, there's modeling going on in the science world that is getting quite sophisticated regarding hydrology, hydrogeology, the movement of water, and including the entire hydrologic cycle. For a long time, we had groundwater law and land law and spring water law and stream law and all that. And Noah and I argued about that in the Nestle, MCWCV Nestle case here in Michigan. It's a single hydrologic cycle. And we could stop at the hydrologic connection of surface water and groundwater, but does that really capture the actual arc? That would be just here. I mean, you know, we might have runoff, infiltration, we might have this arc covered. What about the rest of the arc? Can we ignore what happens with climate change as evaporation begins to, in those climate change years of extreme, the physical causation and source has a direct impact on, it moves water out of the basin. It drops water levels and interferes with fishing and swimming and severely boating and navigation and shipping. So, is there a common law remedy? I don't know. Is it worth exploring? Absolutely. We need constructs to begin to think about this as a society, as we move into this century. I don't think as much effort as we put on atmosphere, and as much as I think and respect and love the work that is involved in the atmospheric public trust cases, why not a hydrospheric public trust case? Why not stick within the water cycle in which the cause and effect actually destroys the public trust in the arc of navigable waters of an entire hydrologic cycle? Scientifically, if that can be proven, what would prevent a legal principle or a court from applying the public trust doctrine if, in fact, it was a significant impairment, like the algal blooms in Lake Erie? As you suggested, Nick, I think maybe with microbeads and others, as we'll see. So, So climate change, dead zone runoff, invasive species, pollution. Oops. That goes to that microplastics. Kalamazoo River disaster. I think the pipe was. Was it under or near Talmadge Creek?
It was underground.
Part was under?
Underground,
yeah. So not right in the water, but still a direct causation. Fishery and public trust, This is Buffalo, New York, and this is an interesting piece about access and passage. Buffalo is trying, there's a struggle in Buffalo to recapture waterfronts in Buffalo, okay? And industrial waterfronts that have deeds going back to filled bottomlands and or de facto use by the public that they're looking at with the public trust doc. So I've got my morning that I got to be done. Water levels, oops. Line 5, human right to water is a case in New Jersey that says, hey, if it comes from a public trust water source, just because it runs through some pipes run by the same government that has a public duty, it doesn't lose its public trust aspect. Very interesting idea in terms of human right to water, the public trust doctrine, and the rights of citizens. So I'll just stop here. FLO has a project which I'll just call it the International Joint Commission Public Trust Project. We started in 2011 with Maud Barlow of the Council of Canadians. We suggested in a report, which is in the Vermont Law Review 2014 called All Aboard, Navigating the Course for Universal Adoption of Public Trust Doctrine. But that started a dialogue with the International Joint Commission. And what we're trying to do is bring, again, the laboratory approach, bringing this to the real world. So we did a Great Lakes Water Level Management Plan. Would the public trust be useful or not? Submitted a report. And we concluded that the public trust role there is a balancing role of competing public trust uses in different watersheds. And there's this accommodation principle in public trust law that I think is useful. Then we did adaptive management, and we did a piece to the IJC on the Lake Erie Algal Bloom Report, and there suggested that there could be a very strong argument that the direct discharge on land in with runoff being part of precipitation runoff, collecting that as part of the hydrologic cycle directly to Lake Erie. It doesn't matter if you're discharging nutrients directly to the lake or you're using them in some way intensified and or against good practice, that it would not be subject to the public trust doctrine. Again, is it a land issue? No, not if we begin to look at these threats that we face in this century by standing in the water with our public trust legal beneficiary or government's stewardship obligation and looking up through the watershed and the hydrologic cycle, and on a very practical scientific level applying these documents or this doctrine, begin to solve these problems. Is it always a lawsuit? I'm not suggesting that. Could it be? Of course, when it's time for the courts to step in, as I mentioned a while ago, you step in. Could it be useful other ways? We think so. We think that actually, if it's a construct in which we begin to think about Great Lakes issues and systemic threats in a more realistic way of standing in the water, as I said, and looking back up the watershed and beginning to protect the public trust, and if we do that, could we make good decisions about renewable energy because of the impact of fossil fuels on public trust? Could we make decisions about farming practice? Could we make good decisions about virtual water? Huge consumptive losses of water because of farming. Intensified, you know, 1,200 gallons of water for an ear of corn for biofuels, for God's sakes. Biofuels use steam generation and use even more water in that and compound it. Thermoelectric power. The amount of water in the Great Lakes Basin for steam generation is absolutely shocking. Look at the DEQ and some of the Great Lakes Commission studies. They've got some great data on that. So this is what we're trying to do. There is a 10-year review coming out from the IJC, the International Joint Commission, in November. And that will look forward to their obligations to protecting the Great Lakes in the next 10 to 20 years. So I encourage you all to take a look at that report when it comes out. It is going to be one of the bases of how the two countries on our border view their responsibility in the future, including, we hope, the public trust doctrine. So, thanks. I guess I'll sit down and we'll go from here.
All the panelists here, join and have a seat here, and we'll take some questions from the audience. In case any of you actually have questions of each other, folks are struggling to do that. We're a little short on time, so we want to make sure that there is some ability to take questions from the audience. Do we have any questions from the audience? Professor Palmer from the audience.
Mr. Gray, I love your idea. I mean, everything about it is just so perfect and spot on. My questions about it have to do with implementation. I mean, one of the things that you didn't touch on today in your presentation, but you talked about previously, is the benefit of the Great Lakes Trail and urban communities as really an environmental justice issue to give a lot of our urban population more access to the Great Lakes. And so my question, though, involving the public trust doctrine, it's really one that I get asked, so I guess it's coming over to you. Go up and down the Detroit Riverfront, and as a practical matter, very little of the Detroit Riverfront is publicly accessible. The Riverfront Conservancy has made a lot of progress in the 2 mile stretch right here by downtown, for those folks familiar with it. But even within that 2 mile stretch, it's been patchwork with progress. But once you get past that 2 mile stretch, southwest Detroit has very little access to the riverfront. And when you go more to the east, we have our chapter on the angle here in Detroit, and you get up to the Grosse Points, you have public parks that are closed to non-residents all along the Grosse Pointe shoreline. And so between a lot of the industrial development in southwest Detroit and the Grosse Pointe shoreline being close to non-residents, as a practical matter, Detroit really doesn't have the kind of access to its riverfront that the public trust doctrine would suggest it should. So I guess something that I get asked a lot is why is that and what can we do about it?
I think it sounds like I wrote about the blueprint for the Great Lakes Trail. You guys have the blueprint for what to do in Detroit to increase public access, because a number of the things that you said, I'd need to know more about the industrial areas and whether or not it's possible to create public access if there were a political will. Is it technically possible, or is that just so contaminated? I don't know the
Physically, a lot of the riverfront has been essentially, we have the equivalent of seawalls. So you have private property that comes up to a seawall that drops into the river. And ordinary high water line is probably somewhere on that artificial seawall.
Right. It would be really useful to look at what they did in Milwaukee with developing riverfront through the city of Milwaukee, because that was probably similarly industrialized and balkanized. And now there's an extensive river walk that was created through there, and it's just radically changed the public use of the area and the economic development of the area, because things have developed facing to the river, and the river is no longer, people aren't turning their backs on it. So you've got, I think there's an example, across the lake for how to do that. And then the other issue that you were talking about with Grosse Pointe and having parks that require residency, I think those are huge issues to look into in terms of whether or not it's valid to have residency requirements for public parks. And those residency requirements have, in other places, been challenged and made invalid. And depending on the fact scenario, if it's a park on the lake, there could be a public trust argument there for access to anyone, regardless of residency.
Thank you. Yes, sir. Oh, I thought you had your hand up. Sorry, I do that in class all the time. It freaks out my students. Excuse me.
I have a practical question about microbeads. So when I go to Bath and Body Works, how do I know I'm not getting one with the plastic stuff?
Well, first of all, ask, but that's always dangerous. Second of all, look for polyethylene and polypropylene. on the materials list. But there are certain products that are labeled organic, right? Of course, you can look for that too. And I would advise seeking out products that say, if you're looking for an exfoliant, that actually say this is made with a natural material, like I talked about, walnut shell, that kind of thing. So you have to, it's tough, they're not going to do the work for you. You really have to be informed consumers, because a lot of these things, if you look at the label on the back of a lot of hand soaps, it's completely ridiculous. And we didn't talk about triple sand and other things for antibacterial, but from the best we can tell from the science, washing your hands in warm water with just regular soap, it does the same thing as using these fancy products with beads and chemicals and all sorts of stuff in there. So you just have to really try and be an informed consumer and ask those questions. And really, honestly, if you go and look online in advance before you do your shopping, you'll find some products and some companies that are committed to not having these plastics in their products.
Okay.
Actually, I have another question on microbeads. So you touched upon state law, federal law, and even common law. But I'm surprised you didn't talk about Canadian law at all, because, I don't know if the Canadians have enacted any legislation against microbeads,
yeah. But,
they are a big part of it, too.
Yeah, no, you're right to point that out, and that's a huge oversight on my part. In fact, Ontario, if they don't have an outright ban, they've definitely taken steps to ban them. And you make a great point, right? Ontario has massive Great Lakes shoreline, and it potentially is a huge contributor. I will say, just on sheer population numbers, we definitely have to look at all of the states and all of the provinces, because, as I tried to point out, if you have just one state or one province in the Great Lakes system, you still have all the microbeads coming in from the others. So, but very, very, very good point, and you should always remember, we're talking about the Great Lakes, to talk about Canada, because it really is an international resource, and thanks for mentioning that.
I might just add, I ran out of time, so I didn't get to say this, but looking at Ontario and Quebec law, Canadians are famous at conferences like this to say, we don't have a public trust doctrine, but we're getting close, because the law review articles are talking about it, and there's a couple of cases Western provinces that suggest there's a public trust duty on the part of the government. In looking at Canadian water law, it turns out that almost to the case, the Canadians go back to English common law with the same cases that we go back to, and the same commentators on the common law back in England, 200-300 years ago. And there's a case called Green versus Meyer, Canadian Supreme Court, in which they said the Great Lakes are in fact navigable, empty into the provinces, are regarded in the Crown in trust for public uses for which nature they are intended. So it's open-ended, the nature for which they are intended. The Crown is the guardian of public rights, and in fact is entitled to prosecute and must remove obstacles that interfere with the exercise of the public right, and cannot of its force curtail or grant that which is bound to protect and preserve for the public use. So I think it's a very solid public trust doctrine. It's just something different. They don't call it.
And I think this is a tremendous segue to our next speaker, who will talk about public trust doctrine on an international scale. But before that, let me thank all the speakers for attending.
About a minute to introduce Catherine, only because I don't want to take any more of her time. We're absolutely delighted to have her here. She's from a lecturer, which in New Zealand means professor, essentially of working with indigenous rights in the intersection with environmental rights. She also has connections with us, which we're very proud of, and that she has a master's in law from Yale. So, Catherine, let's take it from there.
And so, I take the clicker's working now.
Right now, we have this one.
Okay. So yeah, kia ora tātou. So my topic is, I guess in that spirit of Michael Bloom's idea of comparative, but comparative public trust doctrine, looking at how other countries might adopt concepts of public trust in their law. I must admit I was really surprised when I read his article about exactly how broad he covered that. Because he went into constitutional rights to human, right to life or human right to a healthy environment. And when they incorporated guardianship and trust ideas, he goes, oh, public trust doctrine, public trust concept. So maybe I wouldn't have gone that broad, but I'm going to take it. And so, because we don't have, I'm going to look at three main things. And the first one is our concept of the public trust doctrine in New Zealand, how much of it we don't have. We're like Canada, or maybe even less, but how we might be looking at using it. Then other duties of guardianship in New Zealand law, which is in that the comparative trust idea, and then as a brand new proposal for, they've actually called it a public trust proposal for governing water in New Zealand. First, I thought just a little preliminary, this is, I guess, one of my favourite, you know, publicity pictures of New Zealand, lots of blue water. We do have a lot of it looks like that, but mostly only in our national parks. Everywhere that we've been, we're doing this. And we're destroying it very slowly, but surely, bit by bit. And the more people want our beef, lamb, and dairy, the more we are destroying the three of it. Just as a background, a little map on the left, one is the macroinvertebrate index, i.e. healthy life living in the water. The right-hand one is E. coli concentrations. Anything red is effectively dead or toxic. That's quite a lot of the country. All right, it's red. The only bits of the blue are those bits we saw the picture from on the previous slide, which is the national parks and the mountain ranges and things like that. So it's not as clean, green, and healthy as we think we are. We have lots of green, but it's not very clean. We have some algae mats, and we have brown algae mats too. We have a lot of that, and then nearly all of your lowland, we've got lowland pasture areas, because basically if you're not on a mountain range, which is joined with two tectonic plates of joint, then you're on lowland. And so yeah, we have unfortunately a rather large amount of it, but yet we still might click several times. Okay, yes. We just say, well, bugger it, we're going to go swimming anyway. And unfortunately, people do. We have the highest rate per capita of waterborne illnesses in the world. And it's not a third world country, right? Which is a little bit scary. So yeah, we are sort of 100% pure, but in some areas, not all of them. And unfortunately, so we have a it takes a toll on us, but it also takes a toll on our fisheries, so it's not as pretty as the other ones, but a percent of threatened freshwater native fish in New Zealand, we're up to 80%. It's going up, but we're not getting any better. In fact, I know we were late to colonise, we were late to start, you know, destroying the habitats of various native species, but we've had quite a lot left when you look at it today, but we have got apparently again the highest percent of threatened native species in the world, just because partly we didn't wipe them all out already by the time they started surveying, but it's not so pretty. So that's a preliminary background to kind of the physical state. Now a preliminary, I guess, assessment of, just for people who don't know, what a legal state or constitutional. And so if you want to look at public trust doctrine, then you kind of need to know how we're situated. We are a unitary state. We don't have different levels of sovereignty or jurisdiction, and we also do not have any one single written constitution. So we're very much like the British, though without a written constitution, surprisingly, therefore we don't have that power of judicial review that a court might have to use it to strike something down. So we don't have a strong judicial review either. We have a very procedural, we call it weak judicial review, procedural only, and Parliament is sovereign. Parliament, Jim Huffman might have liked this idea that Parliament can do what it like and the courts can't tell it what to do. And there's something to be said for that about having a democracy that where those people are responsible, and you know you can't leave it anywhere else. So, but in theory, because the flip side of that in theory is that Parliament could do anything it liked. It could, and they have these lovely examples. It could, if it wanted, decide to say, well, any babies born with blue eyes on this day have to be culled for population control. You know, if it wanted to. There is nothing theoretically, and you know, apart from this, maybe these ideas of the common law, which is where public trust often comes in, that might impose limits. People have talked about it, that perhaps if Parliament breaches some really fundamental norm, that perhaps someone would say, no, this is a limit, you actually can't go it, maybe judges would do that. But it's all hypotheticals, because no one actually goes around breaching the norms, we think, until maybe we maybe start destroying our basis for life. But you can see there's a lot of interest in New Zealand for a public trust doctrine that's based in the common law. Right, because we have the common law. It's one of the only things that we have if you don't have a strong judicial review for a restraint. So the first thing to say about the public trust doctrine is that we haven't actually applied it in any court in New Zealand yet. All right, and there's a lot of people looking at it, a lot of because it's been so popular generally in terms of discourse. So there's a lot of people looking at it, but it certainly there's an assumption that it could become part of New Zealand law. There's no reason why it couldn't. We have the common law of England that was inherited in 1858. So anything that was in common law in England in 1858 is automatically part of our laws. We had a statute that said that. Even if it's been lying dormant and forgotten, you know, we could still theoretically, it was part of our common law, we can bring it back. The Magna Carta is part of our common law, is part of our constitution. So we have constitutional law, if not a written constitution. Right. So, and the Magna Carta is part of that, and we've got some specific articles referred to it. So any of the historical stuff that is valid in relation to the Magna Carta would also apply. We have two New Zealand cases that have applied the public trust, no, that have mentioned the public trust doctrine, not applied it. One in 1900, which is quite a while back, but one really recently in 97. And the 97 case commented, it was only an obiter dicta, it was a case, interestingly, about local government taxes. So you can see it's a lot broader than any of the traditional things that have been mentioned. But the court commented that, I believe, I forgot Blackstone. So, yeah, this idea, we have inherited Blackstone, you know, along with all of the rest of the common law and his commentaries, including this idea that, you know, man, humanity is sovereign and lord over everything in nature, and we can do anything that we like. Now, it doesn't matter if, you know, say, like that, whatever metaphysical notions may have been started by fanciful writers upon the subject. So that, yeah, we kind of adopted Blackstone, you know, lock, stock and barrel. So this case, I don't know what's coming from here at the bottom, but anyway, the Waitakere City Council in Lovelock, it's a tax case. Right, a local government taxes. But there's no reason why the fiduciary or quasi-fiduciary obligation should not apply and be perceived to be an integral part of a local authority's obligation to act fairly and reasonably. Winsbury unreasonableness, you know, that I didn't, in terms of almost tort law here, they're bringing that in. Whoops. And so the notion of an underlying trust cannot be dismissed as historical anachronism. Right? The perception of a trust persists in modern democratic theory today and has been extended to central government, which I think is, so this idea of trust, even though we haven't said we're applying the public trust doctrine, they, well, why couldn't we? It's a general idea of what, of trust and fiduciary duties. It's not limited to waterways, you know, and natural resources even. I think we've got another one. This shows how broad, right? I like this one particularly. It's got a constitutional basis that rests on sovereignty of the people. Under democracy, Parliament is supreme jurisdiction, in the sense that's used in the phrase parliamentary supremacy, but the people remain sovereign and ultimately enjoy the power that sovereignty confers. So sovereignty, and because it remains with the people, the elected government remains answerable to them in exercising the delegated power. So this all comes up just in a case about taxes, but the public trust doctrine was mentioned and argued. And they said, well, no, we don't have to apply that, but there's no reason why it couldn't. Which I thought, it's a really wide, a really broad one. Okay, so there's that. Now, another aspect in relation, so even though it hasn't,
we have a judicial review power over executive action. We don't. We just don't have the ability to strike down legislation. And really, that's all it is. Parliament, because the Supreme Courts can't go telling Parliament that what it's got is invalid. But our exercise of judicial review has its own rules, right? Even if they're not as neat, right? The biggest rule is simply that review is procedural, right? Not substantive. I mentioned that it won't replace a decision. They just tell the decision maker to go back and do it again properly, right? But there is a rise of a category that they're calling constitutional review, which utilises proportionality. And assesses means as to ends, and so assesses the public benefit of actions and decisions where there are important public consequences. So that could easily be brought in, you know, could easily bring in, I should say, the public trust doctrine in terms of assessing benefits on means to an end in important public matters. I also note that the New Zealand courts are well used to reviving ancient common law doctrines. We've done it before in other areas. The most famous and probably the most relevant one would be the common law Aboriginal title, and that's something they do have in Canada. And we actually, was one of the places we got it from. It was used once back in the 1840s, and then we found it again in the 1980s. So 140 years later, it suddenly got up and ended up affecting nearly everything the government does. In terms, and we had to pass a whole bunch of legislation, and all the stuff the government thought it had title to, suddenly the courts were saying, well, actually, no, you have to show that you've actually explicitly extinguished common law Aboriginal title. Otherwise, the Indigenous people still have it, you know, which could be the whole foreshore and the seabed and all the other resources. And so that was a huge upset because they thought Māori rights had been extinguished, right? But it just shows that we can, our courts are not averse to reviving these ancient doctrines. So you might wonder why the public trust doctrine hasn't been used yet when we've had all these environmental problems, as an example. Probably the first and maybe the largest, the primary purpose for doing so hasn't arisen. We don't have a problem with public access to waterways. Right, that's something that's actually arisen from the beginning of a colony, was access to the beach, bathing, navigable waters. They've always been recognised, and we have a concept called the Queen's Chain, right, which literally referred to the chain of a certain length that was used to measure the distance from, I think it was a mean watermark, up to the beach, right? And that's public all the way around the country. We are not allowed to own the water all the way down. So there's no need for that original public trust doctrine. It would only be if there was maybe the bathing's not an issue, maybe the fishing, and that's not an issue. We're a country the size of Italy, right, or the UK. It's about the same square kilometres or miles as the UK and Italy, and we only have 4 million people. We don't have 61 or 65 million, okay? So we don't have a problem with access to fishing, usually. You know, you can always go, and you saw how long and skinny it was, right? There's a coast's within a couple of hours driving max, you know, so you can always find somewhere to go fishing when you've got public access. We just haven't had the problems that needed it, but that doesn't mean to say that if we want to extend it, like fishing or quality of water, then perhaps that couldn't be revived. I won't digress because when I get off topic, I'll take too long. So I actually think the most likely scope for the application of the public trust doctrine in New Zealand is something I mentioned first this morning. I think statutory interpretation presumptions. That's where we're going to see it first. The court's really good at bringing in fundamental principles of the common law. You know, we still have those, you know, non-retrospectivity of legislation, these human rights principles. Our Bill of Rights is very weak. It's just an ordinary statute. It's not supreme. But we have all these presumptions about whenever a court interprets any statute, not just a judicial review action, a criminal case, whatever, we have these presumptions that you interpret in line with the substantive result, unless there's an explicit statute to the contrary. So that would be a great way to bring it in, an easy way to bring it in. Judicial review is the second one, you know, adding in a relevant consideration for due process, and perhaps as well then as a substantive standard to judge things by. I hadn't thought of the standing, as Noah suggested. I thought, well, that's a good one. I'd have to look at that one. But I can tell you the one place that's explicitly being looked at, actually, is the Atmospheric Trust, partly because we've got that in our news as well, about these children's trust cases. And we're going, oh, do you think we could do that?
And I'll, maybe, just so I don't forget it at the end, I'll say, actually, we've had a bunch of lawyers, myself included, looking at it, and the general consensus is I don't think our courts would fly with that one. We've actually got a lot of restrictions on what you can sue the government for, you know, crown immunity, things like that. And that there's lots of procedural and hurdles that just wouldn't fly, but I'll tell you where it will fly, and that's something, and that's actually an Indigenous rights claim. And then you might think, what? And I'll tell you why. When we come back full circle, we'll see why, where I think we're going to see the public trust doctrine equivalent in New Zealand is through Indigenous rights. And it's, you may, it doesn't, might not make a lot of sense yet, but so, well, no, you might be wondering then why on earth, you know, does New Zealand, why does it have any relevance to something on the Great Lakes, right? If we haven't even formally recognised it in law, well, it's this other trust equivalent doctrines. The concept of responsibility and guardianship that we've adopted, especially in relation to water, and most recently that new proposal that I mentioned, and that's been put forward by a group of Māori that want to establish this trusteeship. So I'll start with the general principles of guardianship of water, and then I'll go to some of the Māori particular claims. And you'll see that really the public trust doctrine is just an extension of what we've already got, right? So it's part, again, one of the reasons why we haven't used it so much. So I want to go back to Blackstone. Remember, we've inherited that worldview, right? And that's that foundation for our law. Right, so we've inherited that cosmology, that of humans' relationship to the environment. It's very different from an Indigenous notion of law and how they relate to nature and their cosmology. Right, but originally, you know, we were all hunter-gatherers. Right, we were all hunter-gatherers, and it was the transition to practice of through the practice of agriculture, apparently, that we decided that we didn't want those natural gods anymore, you know, the ones that governed, you know, wind and rain. We wanted human gods that were above nature, because that reflected our newfound status as agricultural lords over the land. And so, yeah, beliefs change to support our activities. It's like we always try and justify whatever we're doing, right, with our beliefs, you know, from everyday little thing to big picture things. We justify it with ideas about how we fit. And so the key change was this anthropocentric domination, right? Including that nature really is only good as insofar as it's useful for us, right? Well, that's what we wrestle, no, every day in New Zealand we are exposed with the opposite. Still, the Indigenous perspective that continues the hunter-gatherer traditions, right? Of considering that humans are part of nature, right? Acknowledging that we're all this little web of interdependence, right, that we're not actually above it. And so, for example, we have Indigenous stories of creation and others that typically tell us how we descended from, right, from nature and part of the natural world and dependent on it. The traditional Māori view, right, is that all natural and physical elements of the world are related to each other, right, we're all related, and all controlled, right, and directed by the spiritual assistance of the gods. So if we're related, right, then, so this is a quote about this idea of kinship, right? If we're all kin, right, refers to a broad web of relationships between people, both living and dead, right, land, water, flora and fauna, and the spiritual world. A person's inner life force, right, is intimately linked to this is the Māori, is the spirit of others, human and non-human, to whom he or she is related. And that's why tribes in New Zealand refer to mountains, rivers and lakes in the same way as they refer to humans, and why elders speak directly to them. You go talk to these natural features. You have the same equivalent in North America, this idea, right, that four leggers came before two leggers, there are brothers. We don't own the buffalo because he owns us. You have that same saying here. So in its kinship, right, that provides the obligation of guardianship, right, and trusteeship. We call it kaitiakitanga, right, but there a kinship bond implies a set of reciprocal obligations, right, encompassed in this word kaitiakitanga. It's a Māori word for effectively stewardship and the obligation to nurture and provide care. But it's more than just stewardship. It's a collective responsibility of the whole community, right? To one's relations. And so this idea is that if a community exists, then an obligation exists. You can't divorce the two. Right? And of course, you still have, that marriage too. You've got the equivalent. Okay. So how are we going to show you, one of the great laws? We have everything that's beneath us, above us, around us, you know, and then you get the seven generations past and present. This idea that you're not just a piece in time, you're part of a community, but in this case, communities explicitly is something that continues, right? You're not just this little individual that exists now. So Māori have a particularly strong relationship with fresh water, seawater as well, but we're dealing with fresh water mostly here, and have very strong beliefs about what you can and cannot do, on what behaviour is appropriate for that fresh water. For example, because water's got its own spirit and its life force, you can't mix it with another one. You're not allowed to divert waters from one basin to another, because you kill the spirit of both of them. Right, so you can say that, you know, people make stories. Well, it doesn't. One of these things is just like religion generally. It doesn't matter whether the story is true or not. It doesn't matter whether anything's scientifically proven. Right, the fact is, it's a story created to get people to behave a certain way. Right, and they may have a valid reason for it. So this is a story, right? So you can't mix even two clean, different set bodies of clean water. You can't mix human waste with water, even if that human waste has been treated. Right. Because you're mixing a dead spirit with a live one, and you kill the live one with that. Violations of cosmology like this, violations of these spirits, diminish the authority and the prestige of the tribe, you know, spiritually, and therefore, you know, authority-wise, which reduces their rights and their control over their resources, which is, you know, a major violation. So why is all this relevant? Why is all this Māori spirituality and cosmology relevant? It's because it's made its way into New Zealand law, right? We've actually adopted a lot of these concepts of Māori guardianship purely because Māori live in New Zealand, they're part of our people, and there's various reasons about it. I can say from the 1980s, New Zealand has been recognizing Indigenous rights in law, in a wide range of laws, but particularly here in environmental laws. And the reason is mostly reparations, human rights. You know, you had a big human rights movement in the 60s, mostly related to race, right? We had a big human rights movement in the 60s and the 70s related to race too, but our race happened to be the Indigenous peoples, right? You kind of, I won't say you forgot Indigenous peoples, but they kind of been left behind as part of the race things. But we saw that as part of the race rights, right? In our case, it was where they happened to be Indigenous, so they brought a cosmology with them, right, in terms of upholding that. So we, as a colonised country, in the 1800s, we signed a treaty. Well, we're doing one treaty, not lots of them, but one treaty with Māori in 1840, and then, of course, proceeded to breach it and left Māori, you know, with no lands and marginalised and things like that. So, but unlike those other former colonies, well, a lot of them, we've actually given a lot of reparations, very similar to the Canadian movement, right, of both common law Aboriginal rights and then the treaty settlement regime. So we've got both of those. And then along with that is regular legal recognition. Okay, so there are lots of statutes as I mentioned, but here's one. Here is our Resource Management Act that governs nearly everything you can do environmentally in New Zealand. Anything that needs a permit for land and water, except minerals and petroleum, except minerals and fossil fuels, they're in a separate act, pretty much need a permit under this act here. So right up in the front, in the first part, which is general principles, we have section 6. You have to every decision maker under the Act has to recognise and provide, and it's a strong statement, recognise and provide for the relationship of Māori and their culture and traditions with their ancestral lands, water sites, wāhi tapu, that's sacred sites, and other taonga, which taonga's treasures. You've got to have particular regard to kaitiakitanga, which is the Māori concept of guardianship. And they have a separate heading underneath that of stewardship, so for the non-Māori concept of just ordinary stewardship. So that, when you see that in there, that imports the whole Māori cosmology. It's not just a term that translates to our idea of stewardship. That actually imports the whole worldview. And we shall take into account the principles of the Treaty of Waitangi, which is the treaty that was signed in 1840. And we say we're not taking into account the treaty, we're taking into account the principles of the treaty, because there are different language versions, they mean different things, so we have a set of principles that we think have come interpreted that are
some common view. So what does this mean in application? All right, we have a case that said that requires a three-step process. The first, recognition, right, in some form. If you're looking at lands, if you're any application for any permit, you've got to see are there any ancestral lands or waters, right, of a hapu, which is a sub-tribe, to affirm their mana whenua, their authority over lands. I wonder if I'm pointing in the wrong direction. So a decision maker will need to make some practical provision, right, for the ancestral relationship with the coastal resources in this particular case it was. For example, as a part of a team monitoring, so you get a lot of co-governance arrangements as a result. And provision in some form for kaitiakitanga, and this might be, which is the guardianship, which is most often where the co-governance comes in. And so I don't know if that's something you've noticed, but this is a normal court, right? A court of mainstream chain judges, and they just use these Māori words, pepapotted throughout, like it's normal, right? And they know what they mean. And same with the statute, there's no translations typically in there, which is something, again, that's happened through, I guess, from the 70s we started putting these words in. So this is really important in terms, it's a really important backdrop just for how our resource management regime functions, right, substantively and procedurally. Procedurally, duty to consult, and a lot of, not just consult, but then take into account and actually recognise and provide for views, but then also substantive results in these matters. So we've got this in lots of other laws as well, I'm not going to go into those. Something else has happened, I mentioned the reparations settlements, right? When we got a grievance about a breach of the treaty, and we got lots of grievances about lots of breaches of the treaty, and the government has made an effort to make reparations, to settle those grievances. And they've been going on again since the 80s, some huge settlements. And there's been a wide range of provision for Māori interests in those settlements. And they started off with simple things like renaming, place names, giving them their Māori name, right? But all the way to restoring wetlands or restoring lakes, restoring, riparian edges, that kind of stuff, with Māori knowledge and assistance. So there's a lot of the traditional indigenous knowledge being accepted, and then up to whole co-governance regimes. And I want to highlight just two of those co-governance regimes because they're particularly important to, again, as a backdrop for why we haven't needed the public trust doctrine, but what maybe, what could it add or what else could be looked at in it. And one of them, it's the river, all right? So this is the Waikato River. It's the longest river in New Zealand. It starts in the middle from the mountain, the bottom of the mountain, by the lake, and goes through the lake and out to the coast. So it's looking north on that. It's the traditional river of the Waikato Tainui tribe. There's a few tribes, actually, a few Waikato tribes, but Tainui is the biggest one. And they had a huge settlement, and they had been arguing for control back of this river. That was the traditional ancestral river. You couldn't speak of the tribe without talking about the river, and you can't talk about the river without the control, and that historically as well as culturally. And it had been degraded significantly, agriculture and industry and towns and pollution along the way. Hydroelectricity, it's got about 8 dams down the river for hydroelectric dams. It's a big, fast flowing river, right? And they basically wanted return in the settlement. They wanted to know, we want to own the water, we want to own the bed. Government wasn't going to give them that. So they said, okay, we settled after like 10, 15 years of negotiation. I'm not joking, it really was that long. They settled for a big co-governance regime, but a lot of control and a lot of use of their own traditional knowledge, and devolved to tribes some of the permitting processes that came under that Resource Management Act that I mentioned, that normally a local government would control, and they've given that to the tribe, but for everybody's, not just for Māori applications, for even local farmers' applications, some of them have been handled by the tribe. Sorry, I didn't mention, I've got pretty pictures, come up. So you can see it is a fairly big river, wild in places, but farmland in other places. And there was a couple of them. It's an example, though, of recognizing when you're doing a settlement for Indigenous peoples, they want their cosmology, they want their whole perspective recognized in the settlement, and they've got it in this one. They've got a statement that their river is an ancestor, right? The river is a tūpuna, and they've got ancestor, which has mana, the prestige, and represents the Māori, right? The life force, the mana and the Māori. And with the respect for te mana, or te awa, which is the spiritual authority of the river, and it's at the heart, they say that's at the heart of the relationship between the Waikato people and the river. So this is in legislation now. They say, yeah, we recognise that the river's your ancestor, which, you know, is in mainstream legislation. I know that's not applying to everybody, but and I'm not saying it's everybody's ancestor, but at the same time, they see, they understand that Waikato people see their river as having legal personality. Sorry, having a personality. And they'd like it to have legal personality. They haven't got there yet. This one, but they've settled for this, for what they've got. How they describe the river, right? It's a single indivisible being, right, that flows from the mouth, Te Taheke, Hukumku, or Te Puaha, or Waikato. The mouth of the river includes the water banks and beds, right, and all the minerals under them, the streams, waterways, tributaries, lakes, fisheries, etc., etc. But notice the very last one, the very last line. It's got all the physical list and the metaphysical being. That is the definition of the river in this case. It's a physical and a metaphysical being. So there's a lot that could be, they've been co-governing this and this big body for a few years now, so there's a lot that could be said about it, but I won't, but I just want to give it to you as an example for this idea of, and they've taken a much more Māori-focused trust relationship. The body, the river guardians, they're called a different name now. They were the River Guardians. They've got the authority to make rules about the quality of the water that are more stringent than our national legislation and are more stringent than local authority laws. So they have the right to actually force farmers, for example, to have fewer nitrate flowing into the river. You know, they have the right to set those limits, right, in some cases, which is a major achievement. Okay, we have another one that takes a little one step further. Another river, starting from about the same place, right, the same mountain but the south side, coming out. This is the Whanganui River. They've also, again, the same set of grievances, they're longer running. The Whanganui people have the longest running court case in New Zealand, started in the 1920s, over lots of different aspects of alienation, and they have a problem with a major power station that diverted water from one river, from the top of Waikato, and divert it through a power station into their river, and they're not happy about that one. Quite apart from the other destruction of, you know, fisheries and eels and whatnot. They have already had the Waikato River as the precedent. You know, they knew that there are lots of other settlements had been made, right? But, I've got pictures of the river, so you see, this is, you get a lot of, not a lot of people there, a lot of river and a lot of wild. And you also get coastal farmland, it was quite common. Again, very remote and still. And very popular with the tourists, the water really flat. This is not like the Waikato, it's not as turbulent, you know, very popular. If you're into kayaking and rafting, that's the river you're going to do it on. If you want the gentle ride, there are ones that have the rapids. But, so, we have the same idea, right, for defining the river as physical and metaphysical aspect. It's a spiritual being as well as a physical entity. And it goes one step even further than that. All right. That's really weird, all that comes up in one. This idea, ko au te awa ko te awa ko au. That just simply means, I am the river is me, right? And they put that in the document saying that the health and well-being of the river, right, is intrinsically connected with health and well-being of the people. Like, if you don't have a healthy river, you don't have healthy people. And they've used that as the guiding principle for this whole settlement, which is a really interesting one. Moreover, this is the step further. This river
is going to be a legal person in its own right when the legislation passes. This is the preliminary document, preliminary agreement, but they are in the process of drafting this legislation. So you might have heard of it already, but they recognize and they've given it a name, Te Awa Tupua. It's a living entity in its own right and capable of being owned in an absolute sense. Right? And it's got a guardian that's going to protect the health and interests of the river, right? Health and well-being. This guardian's going to act on behalf of the river, hold funds and property on its behalf. This is Christopher Stone's idea of guardianship, right? And this is what we've got. Well, we're giving it. We've actually already got it for a forest, but this wasn't a forest conference, right? And I talked about it yesterday. But we actually already have, and have had for a year, legal personality for a national, was a national park. Was a national park. They've taken it out of national park status. Very scary move. Took a long time to negotiate. Public didn't really want that to be taken out of a national park and given back to Māori. Can you imagine what the outcry would be in a lot of cases? And so, but no, they've got a co-governance arrangement. It's a legal entity. No one owns it. The Crown doesn't own it. The people don't own it. The park owns itself. Right. And the same here with the river. And the idea is you have this co-governance arrangement. Okay. So I can't remember if I was going to say anything else about it. Well, it says it's a legal person. It's going to have rights, powers, duties, and liabilities of a legal person. Only the bed of the river is vested in this case. The water, there's still no agreement on the water. They're basically still being used by power stations and other users. But now at least the guardians have to make all decisions with the river as a whole in mind, right? So even though the bed is what's vested, anything that happens in the river that might affect the bed, which includes the water, can be commented on and made by the guardians. Okay, so that's a second chunk, right? The check of what we've already got with existing guardianship and our laws and an example of how we've gone even further probably than public trust doctrine. But we've now got this Māori Council proposal for water, and the idea is that it recognises a general environmental interest, a stewardship right, responsibilities, an ethic of responsibility, I call it, as well as the concept of the common good. They're trying, the Māori Council is a body of various Māori tribes that have got together, a statutory body. It's led, chaired at the moment by a Māori retired judge, was from a Supreme Court, very eminent, one of the first, you know, Māori judges. He's trying to bring in both the Māori concept and integrate it with Western, you know, concepts of responsibility. In this case, they actually refer to, it was the Hawaiian Public Trust, which helped him develop some of this idea, bringing in those two systems. This is the first concept is the trust. They say, right, that we want the preservation of natural resources for future generations, and we're going to bring in, we want a concept of trust and responsibility, and that's the overriding duty in this framework. We have an environmental interest, right? They want the primary consideration and any decision making under this is to be for the environment, like for environmental flows, as an example. To maintain the maintenance and sustainability. I think it might have been Noah that said earlier this idea that, you know, we haven't quite got that right, this idea of sustainability, and we agree. We need that to be the first consideration for any uses of this water. Then a public interest, like a human right to water. The idea we all have these basic rights. And then finally, they've got a separate category for the Māori interest, right? And that is because they're seeing this as a treaty right, right? So we actually want, if there's going to be any commercial use of water, then we're going to get a share of that use, like 50-50, you know? And so they've actually, that's why there's the integration of the two concepts. But this is the formal proposal that it's certainly being shared out, but I just thought it was interesting how they're trying to do the both. That's our idea of a public trust so far, you know, in terms of the closest that we've got as these two. So if you want to, the conclusion, if you want to sort of think back, I commented earlier about the atmosphere. You know,
I might forget it later. This idea of our atmospheric trust, you can see why when we think of taking a case, say, on behalf of children and taking it to court, where are we going to go? We're not going to go to court under the public trust doctrine. We're going to take a claim to the Waitangi Tribunal, which is the one that's been hearing these grievances. And any Māori can make a claim, and there's no standing issues because you've got to be Māori. It's legally aided. You know, you can have as many lawyers as you like, almost, and research assistants. You can run the law clinic, something like this, to help you. You know, they bend over backwards to make sure that the Māori claims are heard properly, procedurally and fairly. And we're going to bring a claim based on, you know, there's a bunch of children, and exactly the same idea as an atmospheric trust, and say you're breaching all of this treaty guarantees of property, you know, all the forest estates, fisheries, and other tāmua that were guaranteed, right? Because we're basically going to kill them all with climate change. And so, unless we do, quite apart from the water and the other problems, but, you know, they have been taken. The tribunal has made a lot of decisions based on water. They've reversed, you know, made councils do different things with sewers than they were proposing to. It's a huge amount of decisions, and they've come through the Waitangi Tribunal that have the government's been forced to implement. So if you were aware, we've been doing this really since the 1980s. It's not that, well, it didn't seem like that long. But I guess, you know, for people who are in law school now, that's probably a long time ago, right? But so it has had a while to bed in, to develop, and you can see how we've got this wide range, this focus on protection of nature, not for nature's sake, though, interestingly, it's for human rights' sake. So it's still through a human rights lens, through an indigenous rights lens, and we've put those things into legislation for that purpose, but the effect has been for nature, right, and nature protection. The legal personality for nature signifies it's more than just a resource to be exploited, and that's something that would be, you know, really fun to get more of. But what I think most significant is the idea that it suggests that our survival is not separate from the survival of nature, right, that we're dependent on it. So if our nature's dying around us, then, you know, maybe we're not too far long after it, which is the worry. So if we can change the vision, the identity, the concept that we're connected with it, we can change that. We have a disconnect at the moment, you know. If we can change that disconnect, then we might actually end up with better decisions and substance just from a different attitude. So yes, getting rid of that priority of property. You know, why do we even have these bloody fences and this need to say, you know, is it all about money and status? Is there going to be another way to get money, to get status in a different system? So it suggests that we need to go back to something like that. Maybe we need to go back to recognising that great law of nature, which actually was suggested way back. The idea that perhaps, if you want to look at constitutional legitimacy, a regime cannot be allowed, or be presumed, to destroy the foundation upon which it rests. You cannot, you know, part of being a constitutional polity is that you continue. And if we're going to not continue for the younger generations, is there some illegitimacy involved? And I don't know if you can bring that in the public trust doctrine, but that's, we did in that tax case. You know, we went limiting it, which I thought was really interesting when I hear all about the traditional limits. Maybe we just do whatever we think's right. But we cannot destroy the base stock. This idea that we can't leave it to someone else, we certainly can't leave it to future generations, it's actually going to be up to us to do it. And so we need to adopt an attitude, I think, of responsibility. Attitude of responsibility. And this one actually just came from Jacques Chirac and his French Charter for Nature. It didn't come from Indigenous. It's not solely Indigenous peoples that have this concept of responsibility, but it's an easy way to bring it in. Sometimes it's easier to say, I want to recognize a human right, than it is to say, we need to change our way we relate to the environment, because people don't like to change their belief system. But you can still, if your belief system involves upholding human rights, then that's very easy just to extend it to another group. Well, that's what we've found anyway. Much we found that in New Zealand. So, ko au, te au, ko te au, ko au, I'm the river, the river is me. Kia ora tātou, I'm there.